A very good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from John Swinney, and today we're continuing our stage one evidence taking on the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. So welcome to the meeting this morning, Stephanie Griffin, Scotland Policy Manager with the Equality and Human Rights Commission, Dr. Genevieve Lennon from the Scottish Institute for Policing Research, and Kate Wallace, Chief Executive at Victim Support Scotland. So a very warm welcome to you all, and thank you for taking the time to attend today's meeting. It is really greatly appreciated. So I refer members to papers 1 to 3, and I intend to allow around an hour and 20 minutes for this evidence session. So I wonder if I can maybe just kick things off and open up to our witnesses with a question around the code of ethics, and in quite a bit of the evidence that's been submitted to the committee, there is reference to not just the establishment of a code of ethics and support for that, but the need to make sure that sort of compliance and the effectiveness of a code is monitored. So I wonder if I can come to you, Stephanie, first of all. So I note in the original response to the Justice Subcommittee on Policing and their call for views, the Commission referenced the recommendations made in Ailish Angelini's review around equality training for police officers and or staff, and that it should be at a minimum including learning around protected characteristics, acceptable behaviour, the risk of ignoring inappropriate behaviour, and so on. So I know that that's not training, it's not a specific provision within the bill, but nonetheless it does sort of relate to the provisions around the Code of Ethics and how Police Scotland ensure officers and staff are, you know, really equipped as much as they can be with the knowledge, the understanding and the skills that they need to comply with a code of ethics. And I think perhaps that was sort of teased out a little bit in the CIPER submission as well. So maybe just come to you, Stephanie, just to ask a wee bit more about the Commission's views on both the code of ethics, but also how it is monitored in terms of ensuring it's effectively working, if you like.
Yes, you referenced the original submission that we had made in reference to the Angelina's recommendations, and I think in terms of making officers aware of their obligations in terms of both equalities and human rights, we made a couple of recommendations around specifics related to training, and we'd said that training should include at least sort of knowledge of the law that exists currently. Around protected characteristics and what is and isn't acceptable, the risk of ignoring or seeming to approve sort of inappropriate behaviour and personal liability. I think we'd said something around how officers should be made aware of how discrimination can affect the way Police Scotland functions, and also, you know, public perception in terms of how Police Scotland functions as well. And that sort of encompassed in what we said also about making sure that officers are aware of sort of relevant policies, including equality and workplace harassment policies and why they've been introduced and how they're put into practice. I think training, whilst obviously very valuable and very important, and we've stressed that in our submissions to previous call for views, you know, it can't be an end in itself and there has to be a regular review of training. And that should be, you know, sort of standard practice in terms of line management practices. I don't think that we've got a view in terms of, you know, how the code of ethics should be monitored in terms of what's in the legislation. I think that feels like a procedural issue for those probably more in the know about policing structures, so I'm not sure how useful that is.
Okay. Thanks. That's really a helpful sort of background, if you like, Stephanie. I'll maybe come to yourself, Genevieve, just to pick up on the point of monitoring, because I think that is something that in the CIPER submission that was sort of reflected. And it's all very well to have a code of ethics which looks all nice and shiny and new, but it is about the application of the code of ethics and how important it is to make sure that effectiveness is continuing, as you know, as you've got new officers coming in, for example, changing policing functions and so on. So just open it up to yourself, just to maybe sort of expand on what was in your submission.
Thank you. Well, first, I will say that in the CIPER submission, we did support that the code of ethics should be a discipline code. So I realise that is obviously that's not what it is at the moment, and that may not be what is implemented. But were it to be a discipline code, as it is in various other jurisdictions, then it offers additional review mechanisms. But whether that choice, and perhaps something we can return to, is made or not, I think any, both for internal complaints within professional services and anything that goes to PERC, there should be any breach of the code should be flagged so that there is a review process, so that there is data easily obtainable on whether the code is being adhered to, what type of breaches we're seeing, issues like that. I think if you wanted to go further, there's an excellent opportunity to perhaps 10 years into Police Scotland conduct some extensive research, such as an ethics culture survey, which has been conducted in a number of different jurisdictions. There's kind of a fairly standard version from Clockars and others, which has been used Australia and America and various other countries. That would provide a baseline, which could be very informative going in the future, and is something that could be carried out again at regular intervals. So I would say that it would be ideal if you could, something like that could be done, so we can actually determine what impact having this code of ethics has had. And I think going back to review mechanisms, I think the policing board should be responsible for gathering, disseminating, review of adherence to the code of ethics, whether it is in terms of breaches or whatever it may be. So that's comparable to the approach taken in, for example, Northern Ireland, where the Northern Irish Policing Board is responsible for monitoring adherence to the code of ethics. And as I set out in my written evidence, the Northern Irish Policing Board also considers training, which you've already mentioned. It reviews quantitative information on breaches of the code, and it also evaluates qualitative information on how the PSNI investigates and addresses such breaches, including disciplinary action. This is something that may also link into perhaps discussions later on the expanded powers of PERC to make broader policy recommendations and responses to that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks for that, and I'm sure members will come back with some more questions around that interesting sort of notion around an ethics culture survey. That's certainly a new one on me. Just one sort of follow-up question, I suppose, is around breaches of the code and the sort of implications of breaches. I suppose what came into my head when you set that out was just how easy or difficult, what would be the practicalities of actually being able to respond to breaches of the code, given the sort of vast range of potential breaches that potentially could take place. Do you have a view on that?
So it will obviously depend on exactly what the code looks like, if it is simply a repetition of what's there, or if it is developed. And there are a lot of different models out there, some of which are slightly more expansive. And I would suggest perhaps by being more expansive, offer themselves as more of a tool to police to aid them in dealing with dilemmas. in terms of how to monitor it, all of these issues should already be captured, as it were, within either internally within by line managers, or if it's sufficiently severe within professional standards, or indeed by PERC, and it's simply to add something to those whereby you say the code of ethics is engaged. I would hope it would not be administratively particularly onerous.
Yeah, okay, thanks for that. Kate, I'll come to you, and then I'll open up questions to members. Now, in the Victim Support Scotland submission, obviously you set out support for a requirement for a code of ethics, and I was interested in the point that you raised around the need for a robust ethical framework to policing, and how that is underscored by a recent inspection by the HMICS, which made a number of recommendations to improve underlying culture within Scotland's police force. And some of the recommendations do indeed speak to, you know, improved leadership behaviours, delivering a set of actions to address fundamental inequalities between officers and staff, and so on. And one of the things that you also say is the need for, and in fact you say it's crucially important, that a code is both read and fully understood by all constables. So it kind of comes back to the effectiveness of the code and officers and staff's real understanding of what it means to them. I'm just interested in if you can maybe just expand a little bit on that position.
Yeah, and just kind of building on what others have said, training, we think, of its own is not sufficient. I mean, this committee have heard before our concerns about the victims' code and how it's routinely not adhered to and not understood. And what we wouldn't want is for this to go the same way, where there are, you know, obligations on the police that they are routinely not fulfilling, and there's no accountability structure. So really, that's where those kind of comments were coming from. You know, there's various ways that you could continue to test people's knowledge and understanding about the code throughout their career. There's, you know, various ways that you could apply that at the point of entry too, and screen people out of even becoming officers in the first place based on their understanding of what that code means to them and their behaviour. So I guess we would agree with others in terms of a culture of ethics. There's two points, isn't there? One is about using it as a positive tool to promote improvements in the way that people behave and things are done. The other is to make sure that when there's breaches, that those are monitored, addressed, dealt with properly in every single instance. And for me, you need both of those things. The other aspect is public awareness of the code and really making it publicly available and encouraging the public to use that as a tool when they feel that it has been breached, and putting a lot of effort behind that. But we would just really take the learning, as I say, from the victims code and say, don't create another code that's just going to sit on a shelf and no do anything. There needs to be a robust framework round about it.
Thanks. And I think, I mean, in your submission, that there's quite a lot of reference to the perspectives and the reflections of people that you support, victims that you support. I wonder if you can just maybe outline a little bit of just generally what their reflections were on the particular point around a code of ethics.
I think the view is that anything that is transparent and publicly available that can that will hold people to account is better than the situation at the moment. As you know, the feedback is that people feel there is no trust in the process. There's a feeling of a lack of transparency and a sort of a lack of independence, I guess I would say, an impartiality too. So the code of ethics is seen as a really important step, but if used properly, I guess there's a level of I would say, cynicism about the extent to which it's actually going to make any difference, given the experience, and most of the experience, and we can maybe come back to it later, but most of the experiences that we've been writing about are coming from people involved in the Support and Family Bereaved by Crime Service. So that is a specialist national service that we have supporting victims of murder and culpable homicide. Mm-hmm. And there are a number of cases through that service that are coming to light of real dissatisfaction and actually trauma being caused by the complaints process.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. That's really interesting to hear. Okay, I'm open questions up to members, and I'm going to bring in Russell Findlay.
Thank you, convener. I think I've got a question probably for each of you. I'll perhaps start with Dr. Lennon and pick up on something you've already referred to, which was about the proposed code of ethics. You said in order for this to be effective, it should be monitored in the written submission and in your verbal contribution so far. Use Northern Ireland as an example of where this happens effectively and suggest that the Scottish Police Authority could do so. But you also say that this could be achieved by amending existing legislation, specifically the Police and Reform Scotland Act 2012. So in layman's terms, why is this so important? Why is this needed? And have you had any discussion or feedback from the Scottish Government since this written evidence was submitted and published?
So I have not had any feedback from the Scottish Government since this was submitted. In terms of why this is so important, do you mean why is the Code of Ethics so important?
More the specifics of the enforcement and monitoring, I think. And is this perhaps quite an unusual way of ensuring that it's monitored? Could this legislation we're looking at not be amended to do that?
It could. I think the suggestion in my written submission that to amend the 2014 Act is because that's where the policing board's powers are set out. So it would just be the most natural place to put that in.
Right.
You could add on to the face of this bill if you wanted. I think that's possibly just a more drafting issue.
And I suppose it goes to the point Kate Wallace was making, perhaps, about accountability and effectiveness.
So I think, I agree with what Kate has been saying, that there is a need for transparency. So to have effective accountability, you need to have transparency both within the accountability bodies. So there are various yourselves, PERC, HMICS, and the policing board being the major ones, obviously, in relation to Police Scotland. But there also should be there is also accountability by the wider society and expert groups, be it NGOs, the Human Rights Commission, etc., academics like me. There has been a tendency, although that this has been changing in a positive way, for there to be a dearth of data on Police Scotland activities, and equally PERC's data could be improved. So I think this is something where to effectively monitor it, there should be someone in charge. I think that there, which is something we can perhaps come back to again when we discuss the amendments to PERC. There should be a onus on full disclosure, and there should be more on policing coming into the public domain. I think that's a necessary step for accountability. It's not enough to say this is done and believe us people are following it.
Thank you. Now, Stephanie, I was going to ask you about the duty of candour provision in the bill. We've got evidence, written evidence from the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents, which suggests that the duty of candour provision might be at odds with existing legislation, giving everyone the right to silence or to protect themselves against self-incrimination. I think the Scottish Police Federation have said similar to us. Are you aware of whether that is a likely a clash between those two rights, or is this perhaps overstated?
Again, I'm not sure, and that's really within the Equality and Human Rights Commission remit.
Right.
Our focus is very much on the provisions of the Equality Act and being the regulator of that specific act. So in terms of duty of candour, what we had said in our submission to the call for views, and I'm not sure this exactly answers your question, but I think it's an important point to make, is that in terms of the provisions of the Equality Act as they stand, and you know, completely understanding the sort of devolutionary restrictions around you know, sort of re-legislating for equality and legislating in areas of equal opportunities, there still very much has to be a focus on the reasonable adjustment duty in terms of the duty of candour, and that's maybe a point for implementation or for guidance or something like that. But I think it's an important point to make that you know, the duty of candour is there, we understand why it's there, but in order to make it work and in order to make it effective, the reasonable adjustment duty really has to be sort of forefront of the minds of those involved in the complaints process.
Thank you. Okay. And Kate, I'll just turn to you now. I want to just quickly touch on a very brief selection of comments from some of the witnesses we've heard from so far. Stephanie Bonner, who's a mother of a child who died, called the complaints process a hellish merry-go-round of distractions, deceit, deception, manipulation. Maggie Robertson, who was a victim of a rapist, said the system needs to be changed completely. Bill Johnson, who was falsely assigned a criminal record, said the system's not fit for purpose, fatally flawed. And Margaret Gribben, who's a lawyer who represents police whistleblowers, talked of weaponisation of the complaints process. And I suppose many of these is different definitions of victim. And I suppose the question is, from the perspective of Victim Support Scotland, what kind of, if you can give us an idea of what kind of cases you typically see relating to police negligence, misconduct, criminality, and how these might be relevant to the need for this legislation.
So, I mean, the complaints processes that I'm aware of that victims that we've been supporting have been involved in have been quite wide-ranging, everything from criminal behaviour on the part of police officers where they have been abusing victims that they've come into contact with through their role as police officers, right through to...
Can I just ask, yeah. Are you talking about... I mean, I've heard of examples, for example, domestic abuse victims then suffering from their encounter with the police. Is that the type of thing you're talking about?
Yeah, so we're aware of cases where officers are being involved in sexual exploitation of victims that they've come into contact with through the system. And I'll come on to that in terms of talking about, because I think that as well is relevant in terms of the 12 months for officers who've left, because one of the challenges is when officers resign and leave midway through a complaints process, and for some victims they may not know that they're victims until much further down the line, but there's quite a broad range, so that's at one extreme end. The other end is poor communication, and then, you know, I'm involved in quite a few cases just now in the SFPC team that I've been that I've mentioned, where we've had staff in the room with victims who've met with police officers who've said certain things in those meetings and who have then denied that they've said that, and that has caused, and there's been, you know, for some families, given the types of situations that I'm describing, families who've bereaved by murder or culpable homicide, it's quite serious issues, and they have taken up complaints and felt as though length of time for the complaints process, you know, lack of transparency, going back to the point about duty of candour, really finding that a problem where it's not. I mean, I think it's interesting that that's been the response, because if, you know, for some of these things, we're not talking about a criminal matter, if it's been poor communication, but if your automatic cultural position is one of not saying anything at all or defending yourself or not being honest when you've been challenged on something, then that, you know, that is probably the reason why we're having this conversation now. That all needs to change. So there's various different experiences, you know, complaints about personal property not being returned and being lost, and then once the complaint's been pursued in a formal process, all of a sudden the personal property turns up. You know, all of that. There's quite difficult to say here, but I think we were going to be agreed with the clerk that we would submit some written testimonies from families who are going through that the complaint, or who have been through the complaints process or are going through it just now, just to give you those examples, but quite a wide range we've got involvement in.
A broad range, yeah. Okay, thank you. I won't take up any more. Thank you.
I think, Pauline McNeill, do you want to come in with a supplementary or...?
It's not a supplementary, okay. Well, it kind of is.
I'll hand over to you.
Because it was something, yeah, thank you. Good morning. I did want to examine the question, well, what difference will this bill make in relation to the duty of candour and ethics as to current codes of the police officers? Because you'll have read the evidence from Police Scotland, who are very concerned by this and saying, well, the insinuation is that most police officers don't currently abide by some code of ethics and all the rest of it. So you probably read that. So I'm trying to discern what difference it would make. So I wanted to start, Kate, you'd said in answer to Russell Findlay a number of things. And the first thing you said was about you've got some cases where there's been sexual exploitation from police officers. So I just wanted to separate out the different things. So that was obviously a criminal act. And do you have concerns that there's gaps here when there's a criminal act of a police officer in relation to the cases that you have?
That's not the main concern with this. But this, I was using that example because right. of what the examples that Russell Findlay gave me, and just to agree that yes, that is part right. of what we've been what we've got experience of in terms of the types of cases. But that there are obviously processes that go on. Around that. That's not what the kind of our main...
So that's covered?
Uh-huh.
Yep, just to be clear about that. So I'm not talking about the complaints process, because that's clear for anything. Anyone who complains takes a length of time. It's unacceptable, and that's something that could be fixed. So, I mean, I'm sure you of all people are very familiar with the Emma Caldwell case. We all are, in the tragic circumstances. But one of the issues about that case is the way in which the police investigated that case. And that's a long time ago. Is there anything in this bill that would change anything the way about that case was investigated, simply being that they followed lines of inquiry that didn't stand up? And eventually, 20 years on, we had, you know, that became clear. Is there anything in this bill that would allow for a complaint or... anything? I'm trying to come at it as what difference will this bill make to big cases like that? Just if you had anything to...
I think that's an interesting question, and something that, applying it, and there's a couple of issues, isn't there? There's whether complaints made by the family at the time about the course of the investigation. I think I find that easier to answer in terms of current complaints that we are aware of that are ongoing, where we certainly the duty of candour I could see would make a big difference, because the experience that we've had is that officers are not forthcoming, and certainly if they've made a mistake, are not forthcoming in admitting that they've made a mistake, and that then can lead to bigger problems. There's a broader question, I think, that potentially in terms of the Emma Caldwell case around that comes back to human rights, potential discrimination and the type, you know, the potential types of attitudes that were around then that led a dominant line of inquiry. But there'll be others on this panel that are more qualified than me to answer whether this would potentially have made any difference in retrospect around that element of that case. And then there's other stuff around misogyny and misogynistic views within the police and all of that, but I'm sure we'll get to that as well. Mm-hmm.
Would any other witnesses like to contribute to that?
I can speak without any sort of authority on that one particular case, but I think one of the important aspects of the bill in terms of the Code of Ethics is around... the sort of procedures around the preparation and the consultation and the review of the Code of Ethics from an Equality and Human Rights Commission perspective. I think that having those procedures in place in legislation, sort of lends the process more easily to meeting the requirements of the Equality Act. And I think particularly the provision for sort of consulting and reviewing and, you know, the sort of involvement in the collecting of data, which should do, sort of be central to those two processes, are a huge part of meeting the requirements of the Scottish specific duties. I think they can have a positive impact in terms of embedding consideration of equality in the Code of Ethics. And I think in terms of the content of the Code of Ethics, you know, the Bill obviously isn't sort of fully prescribing everything that should be in a new or updated Code of Ethics, but it's more of a framework for the process, I guess. It's not exactly related to the question that you've asked, but I think we do have some views on that aspect of the Bill that I'd be sort of happy to come back on later. Within sort of, you know, the knowledge that we don't have the mandate for human rights here in Scotland, that Scottish Human Rights Commission, so it's very much an equality focus that I would have on that.
That's helpful, thank you. Dr. Lennon, is there anything you want to add?
I think putting the Code of Ethics on a statutory footing is symbolically important. I think without making a discipline code, I'm not sure how much actual difference will make day to day. Equally with the duty of candour, as I think the Angelina report noted, this is implicit anyway. So again, putting it on a statutory footing is, I would say, primarily symbolic. It could be strengthened. So there are other police forces, for example, the Gendarmerie and the Police Nationale in France, who both are required to answer all questions put to them on administrative issues, and that's not uncommon. The question about the right to silence is entirely separate. That is only for criminal investigations. I think it's important to make that distinction, and perhaps we should ask why there shouldn't be an onus on the police to answer questions in administrative settings. It's not uncommon also among other professions, as well as among police and other jurisdictions. That would make a big difference. I think as well that answering maybe not the difference this would make, but what it could make, the duty of candour could be expanded to apply to retired officers in relation to their conduct as officers. That's partially addressed later on in the bill. The duty of candour, however, doesn't apply, so maybe that could be expanded.
Mm-hmm. No, that's very helpful. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'll bring in Fulton McGregor and then Rona Mackay.
Hey, thanks, Convener. Let's come back actually to a point that you had brought up, Kate, earlier, and that's about the bill bringing in allowing the intention for misconduct proceedings against former officers to commence or continue up to 12 months after an officer has left the force. Can I ask you your views on that? Because I think you were going to go on to give us your views, but thought it might come in at a later part, which is now that opportunity.
We think that's really important because we are aware of cases where officers resign partway through a process, and that is really dissatisfactory and can be traumatising for victims and their families who've raised complaints. And I agree as well, just to say with the previous comment about extending the duty of candour to beyond when you've left, but covering the period of time when you were a serving officer. On that point as well, we do think that civilian, the bill could be strengthened in terms of the wording around not just serving police officers, but civilian staff within Police Scotland too.
Okay. And what do you make of the 12 months aspect? Are you satisfied with that? Is that?
We think there should be an ability in exceptional circumstances for that to go beyond 12 months, because there are some circumstances where victims don't become aware of certain things until much further down the line. I think just allowing for exceptional circumstances for that to be extended would be beneficial.
And what do you think those certain circumstances would be? Would that be around about if gross misconduct was proved, perhaps?
Our view about that is that a more nuanced case-by-case basis approach needs to be taken, because it may not necessarily be to do with the type of behaviour, but it may be to do with the actual ability of the victim to take forward a complaint. It may be that they're not able to, or they're being prevented either by for health reasons, for example, or it might be that they can't raise a complaint within a time scale. It may be, as I say, for some there are other circumstances that mean that they're not aware of certain things until further down the line.
Okay, that's really helpful. I wonder if the other two panels have got any thoughts on this part of the bill. Stephanie, maybe come to yourself first.
Yeah, I mean, I think from a sort of general perspective, anything to ensure access to justice for complainants is as encompassing as it can be, it can only be a positive thing. Just sort of one thought that I've had, you know, there's potentially parallel routes to redress, whether it's through, you know, criminal law provisions or if a complaint relates to sort of discrimination, victimisation, harassment through the Protections of the Equality Act. Obviously, not all complaints will fall within those categories. So I would say that whilst the Commission doesn't have a view on the specifics in terms of some of the questions you've asked about time and whether it should be gross misconduct or not, just to repeat that point, that widening access to justice is a positive thing.
Okay, thanks, Stephanie. Dr. Lennon, have you got any thoughts on this part of the bill?
I think that it would be useful to extend the 12 months to include all ongoing investigations as well. As has already been mentioned, some of them can take a long time. And if ongoing investigation had to be abandoned in the middle because somebody hit that 12-month period, I think that would be damaging for both the victims, complainants, and for the process more generally.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, yep. Thank you. Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I wanted to ask you about the culture in Police Scotland. The previous and current chief constables have made statements to the effect that they believe the force is institutionally racist and discriminatory. And I'm just wondering what your impression of this bill is and whether it goes far enough to counter that. Is there more that could be done? I know it's quite an ethereal question, but any comment would be welcome. Stephanie, do you want to?
Yeah. I mean, I think the bill has the potential to be a sort of important puzzle piece in terms of the sort of overall legislative and policy landscape that sort of contributes to tackling sort of racist and discriminatory behaviours and procedures. I think what I would say is we know sort of from the thematic progress reports in terms of Dame Angelini's review that recommendations are being delivered, but I think it's hard to tell what practical effect those are having at this time. It might be a case that the changes are just taking time to embed. It might be just that the Equality and Human Rights Commission, we're not close enough to the process to see what the changes are. But we do know that there continue to be sort of concerning reports in relation to equality issues in terms of police conduct and processes. You know, no point in rehearsing them to people who will know very well what those are. But I think that also another point to make is in terms of sort of enacting those recommendations of the review, the non-legislative recommendations, some issues relating to equality have been exposed as well. And I'm thinking particularly about the PIRC and Scottish Police Authority's review of the police complaints files and sort of finding inconsistencies around training and, you know, access to reasonable adjustments. So, I guess coming back to your question, I do think that there's an opportunity here to sort of improve things, specifically around, you know, code of conduct and putting it on legislative footing. And I think that it's important to sort of recognise that, you know, there's a wider sort of policy and legislative landscape, including, you know, the existence of the public sector equality duty, for instance, that we know isn't always met very well by lots of public bodies. Not, you know, sort of picking out any examples in particular, but our experience as a regulator is that that's the case. Mm-hmm. And in that context, the Equality and Human Rights Commission are taking forward a piece of work with Uniform Services over the coming year in terms of their processes around really sort of embedding the requirements of the Scottish specific duties, better equality data collection and things like that. So I'm not sure if that's helpful.
That's really interesting, and a lot of information there. That's really interesting. Dr. Lennon, would you like to comment at all?
As I've said before, I think that for this were this a discipline code as well as a code of ethics, that would considerably strengthen it, and that there are a variety of ways in which that could be done. That would also lend itself to a slightly different type of code of ethics, one that is more explanatory for the officers and one that I think could be more useful as a toolkit for them, as well as providing a demonstration to the public of the values that they adhere to and that they can expect in their day-to-day contact.
Yeah, that's interesting. Thank you. Kate, would you like to?
Yeah, I mean, it's a tool, but needs to be part of a much bigger piece of work around changing culture. I think it's, you know, a step in the right direction would be our perspective, but it needs to be accompanied by really strong action at all levels, really. And, you know, we are still seeing in very, you know, recent experiences and recent cases of examples of really poor conduct that at times are putting and lengthy complaints processes that are at times putting victims at risk. So
thank you. Can I just stay with you? In your earlier comments, you were talking about transparency and independence. I'm just wondering, some of our evidence that we've heard suggested to us that, you know, perhaps the police are marking their own homework in a lot of cases, and, you know, do you think an independent scrutiny in misconduct cases would be preferable?
Certainly for victims, I think independence would be preferable.
Okay.
That's not to say, though, that in terms of the response to this bill, that we have agreed with strengthening PIRC's role, but yeah.
Yeah.
Ultimately, an independent.
Yep. Okay. And yeah. Dr. Lennon, you agree?
Yeah. I agree. I think that would not do away with some of the issues around delays, but I think it is preferable for a variety of reasons. It adheres better to international standards. It probably reflects better the public perception, who think that in fact PIRC is. Yeah. The independent complaints body, as opposed to primarily review body. Interestingly, the Gardaí Síochána in the Republic of Ireland, so what is currently GSOC is going to be renamed, I think, on Fursu. It's getting a new name, but they're expanding their remit to cover all complaints. And obviously, the Ombudsman in Northern Ireland has had that role since its inception, but the Republic of Ireland is more comparable to Scotland in terms of demographics, both for population and police numbers. So it suggests it can be done.
Can be done, thank you. And Stephanie, any comment on independence?
Not specifically, but just in terms of the sort of provisions for PIRC in the draft bill, I think in terms of the provisions relating to the advisory board to the Commissioner, sort of ensuring a range of diverse experiences on that board is very important and might help Scottish ministers meet their own PSED obligations, such as the need to foster good relations between groups of protected characteristics. I think the bill should reflect the need to ensure membership of the board reflects those diverse and intersectional experiences.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll bring in Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. Your evidence has actually been really good, so you've already answered a lot of my questions already. I just wanted to come back on the proposed time period of 12 months. And one of the things that you had said, Kate, was that some victims are not aware of things until further down the line. One of the things that we've also heard is that at the moment, because there are backdating cases in England and Wales, the time that it was taken to investigate former officers was then having an impact on investigating current officers. So I was just wondering if, when you're sending details in, you'd say to Russell Finlay that you would send details of previous cases. So if you could send us in details of the impact on victims further down the line and why, it's just more evidence that we can get on why we actually need to investigate former officers, especially if it's going to go beyond the 12 months. And I appreciate you said about including the ongoing investigations. So again, there's the current police officers go through the criminal procedure, I think, before they actually do the internal investigation. So I would expect them to continue. But I was wondering if you could just make sure that you send us more information on that. And my other bit would be, what would justice for victims look like for you in terms of investigating former officers?
So I think, you know, the issues that are a commitment to to a trauma-free complaints process where there's really clear communication. I think once an investigation has started, that there's a commitment to investigating as quickly as possible. I think would help. We do think the duty of candour is really important, as I say, because that hasn't been our experience of complaints currently. So yeah, reduced waiting times and a proper kind of. We've got a number of people who've made multiple complaints about multiple issues, and maybe the thing that we consistently see is that only one or two things have been upheld by PIRC. And in some cases, then further evidence has been submitted and they've overturned that decision. So a kind of trauma-informed complaints process itself, I think, is really important, and being far more victim-centred. And an explanation, I guess, the victim care part or the complainant care part running through the system, which is kind of missing at the moment. And we do think that the officers being allowed to resign midway through proceedings is just, and those proceedings then not being taken forward is a massive issue and just causes more trauma. So I think, we're not saying that every single complaint can be upheld. That's not what we're saying, but a proper explanation, victims feeling as though their complaint has been thoroughly, properly investigated independently and impartially, and being provided with information, at each step in the process, so that they can kind of fully understand exactly what the decision has been, and that there's not like a big massive time delay in terms of that being done. But what I'm describing is kind of the opposite of what goes on at the moment.
Right, so communication, explanation, trauma informed, and getting to a conclusion
in a
timely manner. And do you think the bill covers that then?
So some aspects of it, but I think a lot of it is to do with the actual implementation and how it's actually delivered and the commitment behind it. I guess part of it's cultural, part of it is procedural. Part of it is about, your point about former officers and current officers. That's a prioritisation issue, as far as I can see, in terms of resources. And that's, we are talking about leadership here too.
Yeah, thank you. And just one last question for Dr. Lennon. You think that the ethics should be put into disciplinary procedures?
It is quite common, actually, internationally, that the code of ethics is also a discipline code. So a breach of it can give rise to disciplinary proceedings. These obviously range from very, very minor, which can be dealt with highly informally, through to more serious issues, which would be caught by the existing disciplinary code anyway. But as I say, it's quite common. You see it in Quebec, in France, Northern Ireland, and a number of jurisdictions. And I think it's advantageous, as it would require some reworking of what's in the code at the moment. As I said, it could be slightly problematic were it to be simply converted. So references to being courageous, how do you measure that? And do we want somebody to be a breach for not being sufficiently courageous? Is that actually a conduct matter? I'd say no. But were the Code of Ethics to be slightly reworked, I think it is a positive platform that can help aid trust and confidence in the police, can help clarity. As I said, it also, these types of codes of ethics tend to be slightly more expansive, and they can be useful for the officers themselves to actually use this as more than just an attestation, this is what we do, but something that they can actually rely on day to day.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I wonder if I can open up a question about whistleblowers. So one of the things that the committee has done quite a bit of work on in the past is mental health and policing. So both in the context of the sort of growing demand on police officers from people with poor mental health, but also the toll that the job of policing takes on officers and staff. And I think this is an area that CIPER has been particularly active in. We know the toll that a misconduct or a discipline process can take on really literally everybody that is involved. So I'm interested in particular in the position for whistleblowers, and I'm just interested in what your views are on whether or not the provisions of the bill, if you feel they do enough in terms of supporting whistleblowers, and if not, then what else should be taken into account that might not already be in the bill to address that. So, for example, should there be an independent organisation for whistleblowers from within Police Scotland and the SPA? And potentially, should that be PERC, for example? So I'll maybe come to yourself, Dr. Lennon, to begin with and put you on the spot on that.
Well, unfortunately, this is one area of the bill that I do not have expertise in relation to, so I cannot answer on CIPER's behalf. The only thing I would say is that it would be advantageous to have an independent body. Okay. So whether that sits within PERC or somewhere else, but again, that is, I think, recognised as international best practice. Mm-hmm. But I'm afraid I can't comment on the mental health impact.
Okay, thanks for that. I'll maybe come to Kate and then Stephanie.
Yeah, so our position is that we are supportive of PERC's role in relation to handling whistleblowing complaints. We haven't considered around an independent body. That's something that we could follow up on in writing. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But we do, you know, that whole kind of culture of transparency, trust, accountability, it's really important that the treatment of whistleblowers is right mm-hmm. within that context. We absolutely agree with that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and this is all set within a context that I know everybody in this committee knows that public trust and confidence in the police has been decreasing rapidly over recent years. Mm-hmm. But we'll consider the point about an independent body and mm-hmm. we'll get back to you.
Thanks very much. Stephanie, and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill.
Yep, I'm not sure I can speak to this with any authority either, other than to say that I think in terms of the sort of mental health aspect that you spoke about, mm-hmm. I think a really important point is making the process as accessible as possible. And again, that might not be for this bill because of the sort of restrictions around legislating in areas of equality, and that's my sort of specific focus mm-hmm. in terms of what already exists with the reasonable adjustment duty. But sort of beyond that, beyond the sort of reasonable adjustments for disabled people, I think that making the process as accessible as possible to all who need to access mm-hmm. it is a very important point.
Yeah, okay, thanks very much. Pauline McNeill, did you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, since the question of an alternative model, an independent body, has been raised in the lines of questioning, I wanted to ask Dr. Lennon, what does an independent body look like? Would there be police officers on the independent body? I mean, most professions, rightly or wrongly, police themselves or have some representation. And what would the independent body cover? Is it misconduct, all complaints?
So you're talking about complaints body rather than just whistleblowing. So complaints body?
Well, maybe just you could just... What were you meaning when you said that you favoured an independent body? You mean for whistleblowing?
Specifically to that. I do also favour an independent complaints body. I can perhaps speak more about that than whistleblowing.
Yeah, I think it would be helpful, I mean, to understand how it would operate and what would be...
As is the current case with PERC and all the other independent complaints bodies across the UK, and is the norm internationally, the police should be excluded from senior positions in that body. I don't think you have independence otherwise. there is a continual debate on how far the police may be integrated in terms of working within the body, typically as inspectors. I think that as long as they are, my personal preference would be that they should be retired officers and not merely seconded, to ensure independence. But yes, so in terms of what it would look like, it could look quite like PERC looks now, but it's more about the functions. So PERC is primarily, although obviously not in all regards, a review body of how the police have conducted their complaints. Leaving aside, obviously, the instances in relation to serious injury and death, for example, where they conduct the investigation themselves. I would favour that a truly independent complaints body would be a body external to the police, wholly external to the police, who investigates all complaints. Yes, that's what the Police Ombudsman of Northern Ireland does. And as I said, that is what the GSOC, the Gardaí Ombudsman for the Republic of Ireland, will start to do this year. There are obvious questions around resourcing in relation to that, although there are probably questions around resourcing in relation to PERC as it stands anyway. But that would be the gold standard, and that is independence.
Yeah, so you're saying it would be retired police officers and no police officers would take senior positions within an independent body. You accept, though, in all professions, particularly where there's complaints, you would need some expertise? I mean, someone who's never served as a police officer wouldn't understand what the job was, so surely you'd have to factor in... understanding what the role of a police officer in Scotland is when you're designing such a body?
Well, at the current complaints bodies across the UK, so be it in England, Wales, the independent, the ISPB or the Ombudsman Northern Ireland or indeed PERC, all of them by law cannot have serving officers. They've got a list of people who are excluded from the most senior leadership. That includes senior officers. That is standard now. And so I do not think that you need a former officer leading an independent body to understand police complaints. If you look at comparable oversight bodies, you don't necessarily need somebody from that profession. So the people who are in leadership and have been leadership across these bodies, across the UK jurisdictions, in PERC, they've come from Crown. Recently, the last two. In Northern Ireland, current ombudsperson was the head of the public, was the public ombudsperson before, who definitely has lots of experience of, I don't think you can have an independent oversight body which is headed by the police.
I was just asking, you would accept that. There needs to be some representation of police. There needs to be some expertise within an independent body, understanding the role of police officers, surely.
You build relationships, of course, across the landscape, both with the police and the other accountability bodies, and it is a tapestry of accountability that we have. I do not think so. Again, there are arguments in terms of the investigation that you have former officers there who can help understand the culture and perhaps probe better, but I do think it's at that level, not senior leadership.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can come to Stephanie, just a question about the public sector equality duty. So I'm interested in, just in the context of the bill that we're looking at and the public sector equality duty, do you have any concerns in terms of the way in which the public sector equality duty is adhered to, implemented, complied with, in the context of sort of conduct, police conduct, and complaints? Are there areas of concern that you have? I know it's a very general question. So it might be, for example, in terms of perhaps the protected characteristics at all. So it's a very general question, but I'd be interested in if there's anything in particular that you feel would be inappropriate to raise, again, in the context of the provisions of the bill that we're looking at.
Yes, I mean, without getting into sort of specifics in terms of, you know, individual cases, which I don't think that I'm at sort of liberty to discuss here, there are sort of very public cases where, you know, the sort of provisions of the Equality Act have come into play. So there's been discrimination in terms of different protected characteristics, whether it's race, whether it's sex. So, you know, those things are well publicised, and I think it's sort of clear that there is an issue in terms of compliance with the Equality Act within Police Scotland. I think that it's difficult to legislate in that area, obviously for reasons related to devolutionary competence, but I think that in terms of developing a code of ethics, you know, the current code of ethics sort of refers very heavily to human rights instruments, which is one thing, and you know that's not our mandate here in Scotland as the Equality and Human Rights Commission. The Scottish Human Rights Commission could maybe tell you more about that. But I do think there's something missing in terms of the existing code of ethics around the requirements of the Equality Act and the Public Sector Equality Duty. Absolutely.
Thanks for that. And again, I mean, I would refer back just on this to the HMICS inspection of organisational culture in Police Scotland from December last year. And I think, Kate, it's referenced in the Victim Support Scotland submission. So in Recommendation 6, they talk about, or Recommendation 6 states that Police Scotland and the SPA should reinforce the human rights and ethics-based approach for all policing activity. So there seems to be sort of different areas of work that are all coming back to some of the same kind of conclusions. Again, and I'm happy to open it up to other members of the panel, if you feel that the bill, just bearing that particular recommendation in mind and what we've just been discussing about the public sector equality duty, if the bill is going to address some of that in its current form. I'll come back to yourself, Stephanie.
Yeah, I mean, at the risk of repeating myself, I think there are provisions in the bill that certainly help. You know, quality and human rights go hand in hand. You know, they're not completely separate things. They complement each other. They overlap in areas. And I think there are provisions within the bill that really sort of help, or have the potential, rather, to help in terms of meeting the requirements of the Equality Act and the Public Sector Equality Duty, and I've kind of touched on some of those around, you know, the need for involvement and having to review the Code of Ethics as well. So I think there's certainly potential within the bill to assist in meeting certainly the sort of equality aspects that I've raised, but and without overstepping my mandate, probably some of the human rights aspects as well.
Okay, thanks for that. I don't know if you want to add anything on that, Dr. Lennon, at all.
No, I think, as I wrote in my written submission, that the current schedule 2ZA and persons to be consulted in respect to a code of ethics, that the Scottish Human Rights Commission should be added to that. I think possibly the Equality Commission as well.
Yeah, that's a helpful point to raise. Kate, I wonder if I can just come back to you, and this is a bit of a big question, but given that your Victim Support Scotland is such a sort of front-facing organisation, I'm just interested in your views on your experience of engaging with PIRC.
That is a big question. There is an issue, it's been pointed out by others, and Dr. Lennon in particular, around the perception of what PIRC's role actually is from a victim's perspective. Mm-hmm. So there's that kind of challenge. And we do recognise some of the challenges that PIRC have. One thing I forgot to say about the time limit, sorry, forgive me as well, is that one of the reasons we're not in favour of the 12-month time limit is that in our experience it can take Police Scotland quite a long time to respond to PIRC. So that then can extend out timelines as well. So, yeah, I mean, from a victim's perspective, what we see is continually victims with a very negative experience on, you know, the issues, a whole range of things that I've discussed previously. You know, the length of time that it takes, the communication with them, a kind of real lack of understanding as to how they've managed to come to their decision in terms of reviewing how complaints have been handled. And as I say, it's sometimes when further evidence has come to light, they've reviewed that. So there's if we were to go out and ask these people who are being supported by VSS who have had experience of PERC, that would not be a positive response that people would give back, if that answers your question. I am not aware of a single case where victims felt as though the way that they had been dealt with through PERC was satisfactory.
Okay. Thank you. Are you wanting to come in?
Okay. It's a question for Dr. Lennon. In your evidence, you've said that you support a Northern Irish style police ombudsman to deal with every single complaint, no matter how minor or serious it might be. An SIPR is described in the papers as a collaborative body comprised of Police Scotland, Scottish Police Authority and 15 Scottish universities. Now, everybody, including Angelini, is opposed to what you're proposing. So I'm just trying to get a measure of, apart from those collaborative universities that you represent. Is that a universal view that they support a Northern Irish style ombudsman? Or?
So I'm sorry, I should have been clear on that. That is my personal view, right. Not the view of SIPR.
Okay, so it's not really the official view of the umbrella body that you represent? No. Okay, thank you.
To come in?
The SIPR is in favour of that as well. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to just pull the session to a close. So thank you all for your time this morning. This has been really a really interesting session. Thank you for joining us. And we'll just have a short suspension to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everybody. So I now welcome to the meeting Rob Hay, Chief Superintendent with the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents, Mr. David Kennedy, General Secretary at the Scottish Police Federation, and David Malcolm, Branch Secretary, Unison Police Staff Scotland Branch. So a warm welcome to you all, and thank you for your written evidence and joining us today. So I intend to allow around about an hour and a half for this evidence session. And I wonder if I can maybe just kick things off, and I'll just move from my left. So I'll start with Chief Superintendent Hay and move across the panel. And I wonder if I can just start off with some couple of questions about the duty, proposed duty of candour. So I'm just interested in if you feel that the duty of candour, as it's set out in the bill, is sufficient in terms of ensuring the timely cooperation of police officers and staff in investigations, or is there more required, or do you have a different view on the duty of candour? So, for example, one of the things that's come up is should it include a duty of cooperation? So there's a few kind of sub-questions in there, but I'll come to you first, Chief Superintendent.
Thanks very much, and good morning to the committee. Thanks for the opportunity to come and speak to you this morning. I think in terms of the duty of candour, some of the considerations that we've had amongst our membership is specifically, as things currently stand, most police officers will engage with an investigation and will approach matters from a candid position. Putting that duty of candour into law leads to consideration as to the sort of police officer who potentially would not do that. Mm-hmm. Would they now, what level of cooperation can we try and achieve through the imposition of the duty of candour? I think largely what's within the bill will go to achieve that. However, I think one of the considerations from our membership is how that duty of candour perhaps interacts with individuals' right not to self-incriminate in terms of any criminal inquiries. So Police Scotland describes itself as a human rights-based organisation, and that places certain obligations on it, both positive and negative. So one of the things that we would not want to see is for police officers potentially who are investigated for a criminal offence and who, like any other member of the public, are innocent until proven guilty, on the advice of a lawyer, for example, take the opportunity to not provide further information to exercise their right to silence effectively, and then potentially not be found guilty of any criminal offence, but then potentially be sanctioned for failing to adhere to a duty of candour. So I think there needs to be consideration to how those two things interact. And we need to be sure that we're not imposing restrictions on Article 6, right to a fair trial, in a way that is any more so than we absolutely need to in those circumstances. So in terms of the principle of the duty of candour, absolutely, I just think there needs to be care taken in the detail of how that's actually enacted, in order that we don't have a situation where, again, it was described to me as the sort of three bites of the cherry, where potentially you have a criminal investigation, then you have a misconduct investigation on the basis of the specific events, and then if an officer has perhaps exercised that right to silence, then they're also looked at around about their adherence to a duty of candour as well. So there needs to be some care taken around about that, and that needs to be mapped out. But generally speaking, around about that, the duty of candour, I think it's potentially positively received if those potential conflicts can be ironed out.
Thank you. That's very clear. So it's perhaps about the wording of the bill, as you say, to allow that interaction, if you like, between the duty of candour and the points that you've set out around sort of self-incrimination. Thank you for that. I'll come to yourself, David Malcolm, just to pick up on the same question.
Okay. Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to come here this morning and give evidence on this. It's been important to Unison, as we can see some of the considerations for the police staff that we represent in Scotland. The duty of candour is actually proposed to be entered into the regulations for police officers, so that doesn't have the same impact on staff. Staff are actually contractual employees of the Scottish Police Authority, so it would require an amendment to our contracts and our code of conduct, which is separate, and there would be a concern for Unison that we would need to look at where that actually infringes upon our members' employment rights, which is a consideration that we're undertaking just now.
Yeah. And just on that, I suppose, just as a follow-up, have you sort of taken soundings on the kind of views of staff in and around that, the proposal around a duty of candour, but the implications that that would have in terms of police staff as opposed to officers? Are you sensing what the how popular that might be?
Yes, absolutely. You know, our members tell us that it's like they're being treated like police officers, but they're not police officers. They don't swear an oath of office. Mm-hmm. Why should that happen? You know, why should they be considered in the same way? Because we already have policies and procedures in place. Mm-hmm. If someone is disciplined or they're coming under, misconduct investigations, which that's the wrong phrase to use. That's for police officers. Mm-hmm. But if they are being looked at by such as the professional standards or even in our HR department, we've got those policies in place. People go to discipline hearings. There is no right to to be silent on matters. You do have to give your account of things. Mm-hmm. You know, we feel that the employment law and everything that we have just now does cover this.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. That's helpful. Okay. And David Kennedy, I'll come to you with the same question.
Thank you. First of all, I suppose from the Scottish Police Federation's point of view, we didn't believe duty of candour was required. Mm-hmm. And that's because we haven't been made aware of any instances. And certainly I have been defending police officers now and their conduct for over 20 years. I'm not aware of an incident where somebody hasn't given a statement when required to do that. And the duty of candour for us insinuates that officers have been unwilling and have been dishonest. And we've certainly found that just hasn't been the case. Rob's pointed out the fact that an officer has to, under law, be given the same rights as anybody else under Article 6 as well, and that would be the case. And we feel that the duty of candour is not required. If it was required and officers weren't being frank and giving statements, then I would understand why they would want to have that in the bill. Mm-hmm. But the reality is that's just not been the case. The last advice that we received for police officers was actually from Crown Office, and that's when an officer was accused of a crime. And at that point, Crown Office were quite clear, and the Fiscal Service were quite clear that officers should not be asked to provide a statement, and it's because of they may self-incriminate themselves. So up until this point, when the Lady Eilish looked at the view of it, we had never had an issue with it. Mm-hmm. Where officers weren't forthcoming. In actual fact, on the contrary, they were probably more forthcoming, where they would give statements where if they spoke to a lawyer or somebody else, they might have said, you don't have to give a statement at this time, but mm-hmm. 99.9% of the times they always do. And there's only been one case that I know that has been in the public eye, which is still going through an inquiry, which is always to do with an officer has to understand what if they're a suspect or accused or a witness. And once they know their status, they will then provide the necessary statement. Mm-hmm. And when that's clarified, that's exactly what happens. So that is our concern. If candour is going to be introduced in the way it is, we have to make sure that the Article 6 rights are still maintained, mm-hmm. and also that officers' rights not self-criminating themselves has to be maintained as well. And when you put that in its context, you do ask the question, well, why would you need it in the first place? Mm-hmm. We expect most all officers to be forthcoming mm-hmm. and be honest when they're spoken to about these matters. So that would be our position on it.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that. I mean, I'm interested and I understand what you're saying. You've set that out very clearly. I suppose in terms of the proposals around the duty of candour, you know, what the evidence that we have certainly so far suggests there is support for a duty of candour. It perhaps reflects, you know, a robust approach to dealing with complaints and conduct issues. You know, it reflects sort of transparency. So, given what you've said, would the establishment of a duty of candour necessarily change what you've described in terms of, you know, you don't see that there is an issue? But I'm just wanting to be clear why a duty of candour would necessarily change that.
Police officers, they swear an oath. Mm-hmm. They're honest individuals. Mm-hmm. And the insinuation when you apply the duty of candour is that they're not. That's the view from ourselves on it. Because that's, in general, that's what they are. They come and when they're asked to provide the statement, they shall do. So for me, it's a big hammer to crack a very small nut. Mm-hmm. And that's the concern that we have with it. It's that simple. And we haven't had any issues with officers not telling what had happened at incidents if they are going through misconduct. Mm-hmm. And the processes were in place. So that is unfortunately or unfortunately our view. Mm-hmm. And from what we have gathered from the years that we've been dealing with police officers, mm-hmm. If it's going to be introduced, then it's solely the part about self-incrimination that we have to make sure that officers don't, because as law-abiding citizens, everybody has that right not to self-incriminate. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter what profession you're in, you have that right to do that. Yeah. So to take that away from the police officers, just it would not be right and would go against their human rights.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, thanks very much indeed. So I'm now open up questions to members, and I'm going to bring in Katie Clark, then Russell Finlay. Katie.
Thank you, Convener. And some of the witnesses in the last panel were supportive of a completely independent complaints process, which was referred to as a gold standard. There have been concerns about the resource implications of that in the past, but the point that was made to us by one witness in the last panel, well, those resource issues were the same with the current PERC system. So I just wondered what the panel's response was to the proposal of an independent complaints process, which operates in a number of other countries. If I come to the Chief Superintendent first.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think one of the key challenges you've got is how the public perceive police misconduct. So I think probably as a society we have a natural distrust of authority, and that can be quite healthy. And I think there's probably, from a layperson's perspective, that view that the police are marking their own homework when they investigate complaints. However, with you know, personally 24 years' experience in the police and you know, several thousand years' experience among our membership, all of whom carry out roles as assessors and chairs for misconduct, including gross misconduct, my experience has been that actually the level of investigation by the police is at times even disproportionately high around in terms of how stringently those investigations are made. So I wonder to what extent the issue is a genuine one of the quality of investigations, or if it's one of the public perception, mm-hmm. of the way that the police look at things. And I think that to move to an entirely independent, you know, to set up a new organisation effectively and have to finance that organisation, I just don't think that the evidence is there that would justify that. And I'll give you some examples. So, for example, Police Scotland recently re-vetted all of its employees, so 23,000 people, and there was only 9 issues arising as a result of that, and only one of those required further investigation for any level of potential criminality. So actually, the sort of people that you've got in the police and the level of scrutiny that they're willing to expose themselves to currently is actually really, really high. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't make mistakes, and that doesn't mean that processes can't be improved, or indeed that experience can sometimes be really bruising for people that are involved in it. But you know, just because an outcome has been, you know, somebody doesn't agree with it or it's been a difficult process, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's unfair in and of itself inherently. There's always things that we can do to improve. but you know, the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents, we just don't see that there's the cases made for an entirely independent approach.
I mean, putting the resource issue to aside, you know, would you have a problem with it? It's not about whether a case is made, it's about what's the... And it's not just the police, it's independent complaints processes or something being considered in across a range of institutions. So is there any reason why that isn't a path that we should go down if the resource implications were equivalent?
So we would certainly have no fear of it, I would say. And I guess what... The issue I would raise is a little bit around about the challenge that we hear in terms of public perception of the park, is that, right, we didn't like the response from the police, so the park have now looked at it, but who's in the park? Well, it's ex-police officers. So then, is the park properly independent, becomes the conversation. And I guess the challenge is, you know, if you're talking about investigating, where are the best investigators? Well, they're in the police, and they're police officers or ex-police officers. So in terms of another independent organisation, if you want good quality investigators, you're likely to attract ex-police officers, and then you're back in the same discussion around about, well, are they truly independent?
Could I maybe go to David Kennedy from the Federation's perspective? Would you have any concerns?
Yeah, thanks, Katie. No, we don't. The concerns we'd have is how it would be set up, and I suppose Rob has pointed out who would be investigating and who would do that. And I think, although we're not touching, if we just put the resourcing side to the side, resourcing is a big issue. But I suppose for me and the SPF's issues were who watches the watchers. Because if we had something totally independent, and with the way the bill was written, with some of the powers that the PERC, because the PERC were actually more and more, if it evolved that they were like another police force, then you've then got the question of, so who then deals with them when they get it wrong? And I suppose that's the concern you've got. At what point does the domino stop? Because you then have to look at that. But, you know, our members don't have a concern. We don't have a concern with the police at the moment, the way they're doing it. You know, they are starting to get it more right as far as we're concerned in a fairness process. And I do understand for anybody looking from the outside might think, well, how's it independent if it's the own? It's people who are actually investigating themselves. What I can say for the police officers who are investigated, it's very thorough. The misconduct process itself is absolutely horrendous for them, and is actually like a punishment in itself to those individuals. So whatever comes in, we would want to make sure that whatever came in would be fair and done in the appropriate manner. But I don't think we have anything to fear if that's what the Scottish Government or the committee thought it was the best way to move forward. I do know, though, from my colleagues in Northern Ireland that they have serious issues with Pony, and there's always problems with the investigators and how they treat the police officers and how they're treated, and some of the inquiries seem to go on for years. I think the setup of anything that was solely independent, all of these issues would have to be bottomed out before you went ahead to do that.
Convener, is it okay if I go to Unison? Because obviously you organise civilian staff rather than officers, although increasingly many of the roles that your members undertake would be roles that previously would have been undertaken by police officers themselves. And how do you think this issue relates to yourselves in terms of complaints processes? And how does your complaints process operate? And would you envisage it would be appropriate that civilian staff would be covered by an independent complaints process?
I think there's a number of unanswered questions about an independent body investigating police staff. You're straying into the area of regulation of them. My members are all public sector workers. So you're looking at something that's, you know, almost along the lines of like the SSSC for the care staff that we represent. You know, that what does that then impact in contract? And again, as I've referred to, employment rights. And, you know, what would that mean in terms of remuneration for staff who suddenly find their lives restricted in a way other public sector workers are not? Too many unanswered questions on that one for me to have any confidence that would be the right way to go.
Russell Finlay, then Rona Mackay.
Thank you, convener. Mr Kennedy, you represent the vast majority of police officers in Scotland who act with the utmost integrity, professionalism and bravery. And just this week we saw an incident Paisley, where that bravery was played out all across the media. But we've also heard evidence from police whistleblowers, police witnesses, that the existing complaint system badly fails them when they've got cause to raise concerns. Do you accept that the existing system does fall short in that regard?
Mr. Finlay, thank you. I do accept that it can fall short when a police officer is complaining about the police. That's where it does fall short. It seems to be when an officer themselves are wanting to make a complaint, and it's getting that can cause issues. And we've had members of counties who've had various issues with that, so I do understand that.
Does that sometimes put the Federation in a bit of a bind? Because if an officer, if it's a blue-on-blue complaint, an officer who may be a whistleblower of some sort, the complaint often is about other officers. Do you find that a bit of a conflict to deal with?
Well, no, not really. No, we set up so separate individuals to be looking after both members, and with on our systems, they then can't look at what that other officer is dealing with, and that's all noted and recorded as well. If MD was to look, so I don't have an issue when we have an officer complaining about another officer. And in that sense, where it gets complicated is when legal issues become involved. And for instance, if we are giving one officer a lawyer, then the other officer wants a lawyer, and at that point it becomes that the Federation are then funding two lawyers to represent two different officers, and that's becomes an issue for us more than anything. But there's no issue when we have to deal with two sides. It doesn't cause a conflict.
We've seen cases already in the public domain that have cost huge sums of money to settle, which, according to the officers involved, it was needless. They wanted a resolution that could have been resolved much more quickly and efficiently. I mean, there's a quote here from HMICS, a report they produced just December 2023, which says, "Misconducts and grievance processes are perceived as lacking openness, transparency, fairness and pace of resolution. There's a general lack of trust in these processes, and we found they are having a direct and often damaging short and long-term impact on individuals and teams," which pretty much reflects what you've just acknowledged. So how could this bill, I mean, do you not welcome any parts of the bill, or are there parts of the bill that would help to support your members who find themselves in these positions?
Well, the question that's just been asked about the independence, that could be something that does support somebody who's making a complaint. And it's the problem you have with the current misconduct regulations, they have never been invoked to the way they should have been. And the 1996 conduct regulations were adversarial. They meant that at the end of a hearing, officers were given fines. I mean, we had officers getting fines for being in debt, which is just ridiculous, to give them a fine and put them in a worse position than they were before they committed conduct. When the 2014 regulations came in, they were on the back of the Taylor reforms that were looked at in England and Wales. And the problem we have is they have never been enacted properly to the way they should be. If you misconduct regulations are going to work, you have to learn from them. And that is so important. And that's, they're seen as a punishment. There's no learning coming from the service from any of the outcomes of misconduct. And that would then assist the processes when they get them in place. What we currently have is the misconduct regs, as they're laid at this moment, they would do the job properly. But the problem we have is when the service look at an issue with an officer, they investigate it like a crime, which they shouldn't be. They then investigate it at the top level and not the bottom level, which to look at it at the lowest level first is so you get people around the table, you get a resolution and you sort it out. And that would be particularly beneficial for a lot of the cases you're talking to me about with officers who are complaining about officers. But that's not how it's dealt with. And it's the adaptation of the current regulations from me that causes the biggest issue in how they're processed.
One issue, which is a bit of an elephant in the room, is the cost, of the potential cost of this legislation. The initial financial memorandum put the figure at £1.4 million or thereabouts. And the latest figure from the Scottish Government is approximately £5.8 million, which is more than 300% higher. Just yesterday, the convener of the Finance Committee of the Parliament, who's an SNP MSP, said that the Scottish Government, and I quote directly, knowingly presented figures to the Finance Committee which they knew were completely inaccurate. Now, this is a charge denied by the SNP Justice Secretary, but clearly this is of significant concern. I just wonder whether any of you have any insight in terms of quantifying whether that 5.8 million is realistic, whether it's likely to go higher, and what that might mean for policing generally. I don't know who wants to take that.
I don't mind it. I believe it is unrealistic. I don't believe the figure has looked properly at the actual cost of an investigation from start to finish and how that affects the service. Where if you, they haven't taken into cognizance of the salaries of the people who are investigating it, the cognizance of the times lost and the money that's wasted while officers are either taken off the street and not allowed to be in the community dealing with the public. They've not taken into cognizance of the legal costs that then coming off the back of that. We're aware of, on average, you know, we have tried to look at the costs, and it's very difficult to get that figure. But we know, I've had members who on legal bills have been anything between £20,000 to £70,000 looking through it for one individual. And that's just their legal bill. You take their wages, the investigation that's taking place. I think the figure's probably at least five times as short as what it'll actually cost the service.
So on the basis of that estimate, you'd be thinking five times the 5.8?
Yes.
Potentially.
Absolutely.
But that, again, is pretty speculative.
Yeah, it's totally speculative because you'd have to sit down and look at each case to see how much is that cost, how much is it wasted time for the public, the communities that have lost the officers. When we reported back on the financial bill, we were quite clear to say that the numbers are made up. They're not. There's no value on them correctly.
Is that view shared by ASPS?
Yes, Mr. Finlay is. In terms of that number, I would hate to put a figure on it, but actually when you look at mapping out what David's described there about the true opportunity cost that's lost, and then on top of the enhanced level or a high likelihood of more legal representation, we do think it's likely to be far in excess of that 5.7 million potentially.
Okay, thank you. And maybe, I don't know if David's...
Yeah, no, I would like to respond to that. Certainly haven't had any engagement with anyone on figures, but in hearing you say that, I consider how long it takes in investigations when I look at members of my union who have been suspended for over 2 years, the cost implications, the legal implications, reflecting what David has said. And Police Scotland do like to measure in terms of capacity. They like to talk about freeing up capacity. They will lose, they lose capacity to these things by not, moving and expediting these processes. So the higher number does sound like it's more likely to be that to me.
Sticking with costs, and it's specific to your evidence, Mr. Malcolm, the proposal that civilian employees would effectively come under the duty of ethics and sort of fundamentally change their employment status. I think you said this would interfere with their existing employment rights. They would effectively become a regulated workforce, such as police officers. And I think in your written submission, it made a very useful comparison, saying you wouldn't treat non-medical NHS staff in the same way as you would treat doctors and nurses. But it's the last line that caught my eye, and it said, should any change of status be imposed, remedying such disparities would be a matter of urgency for Unison. Now, reading between the lines, that sounds very expensive. It sounds like Unison would be banging down the door of the SPA saying each and every one of our members who's subject of these new regulations deserves a pay rise. Is that what that means?
Thank you. You've got that very correct. We're looking at the fact that, as I mentioned earlier, a regulated workforce, and we would expect a remuneration for that, and in comparison with other public sector. And our concern over, we're prepared to look at, do we need to actually take, we've spoken briefly on some legal advice, would we need to actually legally challenge that? Because the situation could lead to, we're talking about changes to contracts, does it infringe on employment rights? If it does infringe on employment rights, that's a reserved matter for Westminster. That's entering into a Section 35 territory.
So would an easy fix
and to be amend this legislation to preclude the civilian staff?
It would be, yes.
Right. Is that something you're actively lobbying the government on?
I would be, yes.
Uh-huh. But prior to publication of the bill, there was no conversation between Unison and the government?
No, that's correct. It was earlier this year, I think, that we got our first engagement on it, because I think the consideration up to that point had been that it didn't include staff.
Yeah.
And then I think, you know, representations were made by people that felt that it should include staff.
I just wonder whether this £5.8 million figure includes the potential for this dispute. I don't know if you would know that.
Well, I wouldn't know that, no. But I would suggest not.
Yeah, OK. Right, thank you. Thank you.
Rona McCoy and then Sharon Dowie.
Good morning, panel. if I could start with Mr Kennedy. I was interested in your response to the convener's questions about duty of candour. And I don't know if you've been aware of the evidence that we've heard over the past few weeks. I would like to turn the dial back to the experience of police under disciplinary procedures and the public. And quite honestly, that evidence was pretty shocking. you're on record as saying you don't think there's a need for this bill. Now, I'm just wondering how that squares with what we've heard. I appreciate it's a minority of officers that have been involved in some of the things that we've heard. But are there no aspects of this bill that you think could be used to improve the experience of victims and witnesses?
I think there's various aspects to the bill that will help victims and witnesses. But for ourselves, obviously, I'm looking after the police officers who the bill is mostly going to affect.
Some of our evidence was from police officers.
Yeah, and a lot of those police officers, I can't disagree with you, they'll have their own experiences where they have felt. But I can say I've dealt with a lot of those police officers as well, and there was issues that were bottomed out that then never got bottomed out for some of them. My point is the current regulations are not getting used in the manner in which they should be, and that's the reason why we're saying the bill wasn't needed, because if they had been used properly, when the misconduct regulations were released, we also had the performance regulations. They have never been used.
You know, whose responsibility is it?
It's Police Scotland's responsibility for that, and they don't use them. When the current 2014 regulations were laid down in Parliament, the performance regulations were also laid down as well. Now, to date, over the last 11 years, there's only been three officers who have ever fully went through those performance regulations, and it's only been for capability. It's never been for the performance. And the whole point in the new regulations was to look at how do we change behaviour. Are we using them to punish people, or are we using them to change their behaviour? And that has never been done correctly. And that's, for me, is the most disappointing fact, because when the new regulations came in at 2014, that was the whole purpose of them, to make sure that things were done correctly, to make sure at the point of somebody making a complaint, it was fixed at that point. And that's never happened. They haven't done that. They've set the bar far too high in the misconduct regulations. And to be frank, they're not even looking at the performance regulations. And they were set out to be fair and also have an end. If people don't perform, ultimately, they could lose their job because of it. They're not getting used. And the foresight of those who used those regulations had said that when these regulations come into play, 85-90% of the issues we should be seeing in performance now, not in conduct. It's never happened. Now, why has it never happened? It's possibly never happened because we don't have a performance department in Police Scotland. We have got a conduct department. We don't have a performance department. It's not been pushed enough. But I think we've failed in the legislation that was passed all those years ago, and it hasn't been done properly. And that's our biggest concern with the bill, because the bill's coming in, but it's based on the evidence, which is correct, of what people have had and have felt. But if they had used the regulations and the performance regulations as they were set out originally, I don't believe we'd be here.
Chief Superintendent, hey, I'm sure you want to respond to that.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I think probably the quote from HMICS kind of highlights some of the issues around about this. The service is excellent at attributing personal responsibility,
but actually without the ability for it to reflect an organisational responsibility. That's why we see a lack of progress under the performance regulations. Now, that's quite stark when you think about, yes, low numbers of misconduct, but vanishingly small, almost zero numbers of performance in that same time. So what we're saying is all these police officers were bad and it was all their fault, but there was no wider organisational responsibility around about how did we train and equip them to do the job we were asking them to do. And I'll give you an example of this. I know that the committee will have heard and discussed the Rona Malone case. So the supervisory officer involved in that clearly made sexist comments. But until 2021, there was no equality, diversity and inclusion training in Police Scotland. So there needs to be the ability for the organisation to reflect on its responsibilities rather than just being incredibly good at identifying individual officers who have done wrong and actually say, how are we equipping people to do right? So process and procedure is clearly one side of misconduct. The other part of that is culture. And you know, it's difficult for a legislator to legislate for culture. But that's at least 50% of the challenge that we've got here.
Okay. Did I hear you correct when you said that there was no equality and diversion training before 2021? I'm surprised at that. I've asked that in the previous Justice Committee when this was being talked about, and I understood that that was being done, but you've said not. So who is responsible for this, not the current, as David Kennedy has pointed out? Who's ultimately responsible for that being carried out properly?
So I mean, ultimately the Chief Constable is responsible, but it's that leadership responsibility about making sure that these fundamentals are in place so that police officers are able to rise to the challenge of the very challenging role that we ask them to do and are supported to do it right. And when they don't get that right, that then looking candidly at, is this a case of we just haven't equipped them properly, or is there something fundamentally wrong with that police officer? The reason I know about the ED&I training, because I'm a former head of training at the Scottish Police College and I introduced it in 2021. I also oversaw the largest influx of probationers into the service since 2007. And when we have a course of 200 or 300 passing off the square, not one of those officers wants to go to their work and do a bad job. They are all wanting to go out there and serve the public to the absolute best of their ability. So what happens to them afterwards? How do we end up in this situation where they're misconducting themselves or they're not performing at the level? And that's where there needs to be a much more frank examination of the organisational circumstances. That responsibility needs to be as apparent as the individual responsibility that rests with officers as well, if we're to be successful in what we want to do.
Okay, David Malcolm, do you want to comment on it?
Well, if I'm correct, your question is that are there any aspects of the bill that would work for police staff in terms of discipline? And my response to that is that I feel that we do have in Police Scotland very highly trained, knowledgeable HR professionals that I represent. They deal with police staff. They should be allowed to deal with the discipline matters correctly, but they do tell me that they do feel overridden quite a lot by senior police officers and professional standards department. So it should work already. You know, a code of ethics would not make any change to that. That is where we really need to focus, you know, and make our representations to the SPA and their scrutiny, that is the sort of power that the HR should have and lead with.
Okay, thank you. Just one final, is that okay? Yeah, as part of the evidence we have heard, the mention of non-disclosure agreements was brought up. I want to ask what you know of that, if that's taking place. Yes, David?
It absolutely does take place. Uh-huh. And non-disclosure agreements will be written regularly by any case that goes to an employment tribunal. And it's a Court 3 agreement, is what they would call it. And that does take place. So anybody who comes here and says that non-disclosure agreements aren't taking place is not telling the
view on that.
Well, they shouldn't have to write non-disclosure agreements. Mm-hmm. That's always been our view. The problem you have is sometimes to get, certainly the Federation's point of view is it's down to the individual officer. We've told them that if they don't want to sign a non-disclosure agreement, they shouldn't need to sign it. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, Police Scotland won't necessarily agree for an ET not to go to a full employment tribunal unless you do.
Okay. Chief Superintendent, would you like to?
Yeah, similarly, you know, we were of the belief that non-disclosure agreements preclude organisational learning. And ultimately, you know, taking aside the individual circumstances of any case, the goal has to be embedding organisational learning to learn from our mistakes. You know, policing is a human endeavour and mistakes will occur. But actually what we should be doing is taking those mistakes and using them to make us a better and more effective service. And if we can't discuss the circumstances that have given rise to any particular aspect of misconduct, how can we learn from that? How can we embed that learning? So
the non-disclosure agreement means that certain people can't discuss it.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. That's why we're unsupportive of non-disclosure.
So you're unsupportive?
Of non-disclosure agreements, yeah, they should not
but
be
they're happening.
Being used. And they shouldn't be, yeah.
So whose responsibility is that for them not happening?
Who's I mean,
okay.
It's Police Scotland's legal department that are responsible for it, and I can tell you right now, 99% of every single legal case that gets settled, they will sign a non-disclosure agreement, and that officer will not be able to speak about what happened within that employment issue. Otherwise, they won't receive it. And for some officers, they sign it because they just want to put a close to it. Okay. Doesn't stop ourselves speaking on it, which we pointed out to officers, but that is there, and it's real, and it's happening right now.
Okay, thank you. David, does it affect staff?
Yes, I do have knowledge that staff have signed non-disclosure agreements, COT 3 agreements, as Mr Kennedy referred to, and it does preclude us from being able to discuss issues that we do see of discrimination within the organisation. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Before I bring in Sharon Dowie, I wonder if I can just come back to the point about training and performance. I was really interested in your exchange with Rona Mackay on that, and I get quite exercised about the issues around training and how that links to performance, and then that links to, you know, some of the issues that we're looking at in terms of the bill today. So we've made reference earlier on in the meeting to the HMI's inspection of organisational culture, and his report came out last year, and I'm possibly putting you on the spot a little bit, but do you know, in terms of some of the recommendations that were made in that report, so just one of them, recommendation 3, is around Police Scotland ensuring the probationer training syllabus is more reflective of actual frontline demand. Recommendation 4, Police Scotland should prioritise the completion of an organisational maturity assessment of continuous improvement, organisational learning, which we've just spoken about. What is the process in terms of those recommendations being actioned by Police Scotland? Be interested in anything that you can maybe share with the committee around this particular report.
So typically what would happen in response to any HMICS report would be an improvement plan would be put in place, mm-hmm. and the actions within the recommendations would be assigned to specific departments in order to carry them out, to discharge them fully. For example, the one around about probationer training would go to our learning, training and development department. One of my colleagues, Chief Superintendent Alan Gibson, he's in charge of that particular department. And I know that probationer training is one of the key elements that they're looking at in terms of that. I guess because probationer training for us is a 92-week journey, What tends to happen is people focus on the first part when the probationers are at the Scottish Police College. And actually, I think if you read the HMICS report, that describes that as actually a really good environment for people coming into the service. But what we need to do is make sure that the subsequent weeks when they go back to division, they receive appropriate support and training in order to make sure that quality of training experience and embedding people into the service is commensurate with what we would hope it to be in that time. Mm-hmm. And the challenge for us right now in terms of ensuring that is the real challenge around about police officer resources on the street.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. And just one sort of final point, I suppose. The first recommendation in that report relates to improving leadership behaviours across the organisation. And I was interested in your comments about equality and diversity training being resumed in 2021. Was the amalgamation of the 8 forces into one anything? Was it anything to do with the change in the delivery of equality and diversity training, as I understand it, and I think from Rona Mackay's reaction, our understanding was that that's a key part of probationer training in particular.
So probationers have always received that equality and diversity training as part of the initial training course. But if you imagine when we amalgamated in 2013, there was over 10,000 different course descriptors for training products. So the first part of the Police Scotland journey was definitely one around about consolidation and standardisation. And a number of things in terms of training, you know, fell lower in terms of priority. One of the areas that ASPS has pushed the service on for some years has been in that space of equality, diversity and inclusion. The previous president before myself was a former chair of the Scottish Women's Development Forum within Police Scotland. We pushed heavily into the sexism and misogyny piece. I'm a former chair of the Forces Allies Network for LGBTI allies, and we've challenged the service around about support to LGBTI officers within the service. So we have always seen this as an area that the service has needed to develop. And I'm pleased to say, you know, since while you know there was certainly a gap and a huge strategic risk while that training wasn't offered in terms of annual refresher, the service has now picked up that baton and has started to move forward at pace in that area, which I think is really encouraging to see, and you know, is definitely a positive development.
And do you think that this, the what you've just sort of set out very helpfully, does have a bearing on misconduct, performance, complaints? So, you know, there is a direct link, if you like, to the provisions of the bill.
I would agree, yeah. I think all these things help to set the culture within the organisation. And I think I would highlight, you know, what David said at the start, is what we've seen is actually some improvements in terms of PSD, improvements in terms of the internal culture within the organisation. The service has had to react to some of the cases that I know the committee will have heard about. And actually, the level of reaction is probably more genuine and authentic than perhaps I've seen in the past, where it's tended to be perhaps more of a defensive response. There's actually a greater level of examination around about what can we do, how can we change the culture of the organisation and actually move things on. You know, for example, making that code of ethics come to life within the organisation, highlighting the standards of professional behaviour. So I think, you know, for things within the bill that certainly are broadly supported by our membership, you know, putting the code of ethics on a statutory footing, I think, you know, is a good thing and is something that would be well supported.
Thank you. I don't know if David Malcolm, if you want to comment on that at all before I bring Sharon Dowie in.
I mean, I would say that for police staff, training on equality, diversity and inclusion is probably quite lacking. We no longer receive an in-person induction for staff, so any new members of staff that come in will receive an online presentation, which used to happen in person. It was something that I used to attend myself, and, you know, so that is lacking there, to actually have that, you know, in-person talk, the engagement about why this is important. You're simply doing something online, and in some occasions I've heard of people doing that induction 9-10 months after they've actually joined the organisation. So certainly in terms of equality and diversity, it feeds into that. In terms of your ask about, you know, recommendations and how they're implemented, I often comment to my colleagues that Police Scotland will set up a meeting to have a meeting. You know, that this is the culture within it, and action is because of a large amount of ongoing meetings to discuss how we'll do things. I think that they have seized upon the idea of the code of ethics solves a lot of issues for them, because they don't need to make decisions on how they're going to implement certain things that they're failing to do, like David has referred to, you know, the performance measures. So, you know, I think that there are other ways that they can deal and improve without the needs of this bill.
Thank you. Okay, I'll bring in Sharon Dowie and then Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Probably going back onto the financial memorandum, Russell Finlay already commented it's went from 1.4 million to 5.8 million, which is a huge, huge cost. And we've obviously heard the comments about whether or not legislation is actually required. Earlier on, David, you had said about when it comes to officers, you investigate it at the top level instead of the bottom level. And from some of the evidence that we've already heard, it actually sounds as if it had been investigated at the bottom level first, it would have been dealt with through maybe misconduct or a disciplinary procedure without it maybe having to go to a criminal case. And we also hear about officers that go through a criminal case, get acquitted, and then they come back to the misconduct. So is it okay? Do you think that we actually just need to go back in and look at the current policies, procedures, processes within Police Scotland, maybe update them and implement them properly? Because you'd actually said as well about current regulations not being used in the way they should be. So do you think we need legislation, or do you think we need to go back and actually look at the processes and procedures that are already there, implement them properly and possibly update them? If I can start with David.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Ms. Dow. Yes, absolutely. I do think that would be the case. If we look at the legislation that's currently in place, the regulations that are in place, if they were adopted properly, the issues you have within the police service is when if an officer says something and say they swear at one of their colleagues, a supervisor can then say, well, is that a breach of the peace? So they will then investigate that as a crime. And then it will go all the way to the Crown Office Fiscals to say, is this a crime? Is this a breach of the peace? But then it all comes all the way back to say, no, it's not. Deal with it at misconduct. Now, in any other employment, somebody would just deal with it. It wouldn't go to Crown to say, can we confirm that? Is this a crime? And that's what we see at a lot of the lower level issues within the police service. They're not dealing with it at the appropriate level. And the police service will say, well, if it's deemed to be a crime, it will have to go and will have to be come back to us. And that's the way. So that if that was changed, that would certainly allow managers to deal with it at that level. And actually say to two people, can we please have an apology there and don't speak to a member of staff like that? And the matter perhaps would be dealt with. And that's the exact same when you look at the misconduct. Everything's deemed to look at gross misconduct, where the whole point of the new regulations was to deal with it at the lowest level, deal with it at source and fix it. And then if there was a performance issue from somebody, then they would then move to the performance regulations and you would say, well, your performance is out. It's not correct here. There's a process in place for you to make sure you fix your performance and make sure it doesn't happen again. Then we've just saved a lot of money. We're sorting it for both individuals. The person who's obviously been the victim will get satisfaction in the sense that it's being resolved at a very early stage, and then the individual who's caused it is then getting fixed. Now, if they do it again, then that may be different. They may look at it and say, well, you've already been through your performance, you're not improving, we're now going to look at the misconduct or gross misconduct, if that would be the case. But we're not doing it that way. Everything, it's top level first and then bottom level last. And I think you're right. I think if we actually properly sat down, looked at what we have in place at the moment, we could fix a lot of these issues. The case with Ronan Malone, if I may add, was solely down to one thing, and it was down to that non-disclosure agreement. Because if they had not forced that upon her at that time, I think that would have been resolved right at the very beginning. But there's another example of the amount of money that's cost the service and the public purse and people's health, because that's one of the biggest things that there's no cost on. We have so many police officers now who go through the misconduct process and went through the criminal process, who basically have to leave, not because they've been found guilty, not because they've been found guilty of misconduct, because the actual system and the way what they're put through absolutely destroys them, and they leave the service, and there's a cost there that's never been flagged out in any of this. So I absolutely agree. If that was a decision of this committee and government, I think that would be extremely good.
Thank you. Rob, do you want to comment?
Yeah, I think the question around about, you know, it needs to be framed in terms of your objective. So I broadly agree with David in terms of, is it functionally necessary? So we represent a range of superintendents, including those in senior management positions within PSD, and my colleagues aren't coming to me saying, we definitely need new legislation to deal with the issues of gross misconduct within the service. They've recently undertaken a really extensive campaign on the standards of professional behaviour, seeking to really embed that in the sort of day-to-day life of the service to make it really apparent and explicit to officers what's expected of them. They've started to publish the outcomes of gross misconduct on the force intranet, so that officers, in an anonymised fashion, of course, so that officers are aware of these are the sort of things that will cost you your job. So it's really, really clear.
So they're leaning in to improve things within the framework of what's what exists currently. I guess the challenge exists for us as a service that's based around about policing by consent, is the damage that's been done to the reputation of policing by previous scandals and often things that have happened out with Scotland as well. So the question there about what is sufficient to satisfy the Parliament, our oversight bodies, that we are taking the necessary steps, what's sufficient to embed public trust and confidence. I think functionally within the current regulations, if they were applied better and if we were able to better identify issues of performance, if we were more open about where the organisation has contributed towards failings and we're more open to organisational learning, I think we could absolutely improve within that context.
Thank you. You'd actually mentioned the case earlier, Rona Malone. We also heard from another witness who basically was put in restricted duties, told that he was a danger to the public, but hadn't actually been informed why. He went all the way through a criminal case, was acquitted, by which point I think he'd already taken early retirement. So can I ask why you do the criminal case first and you don't do like a misconduct or an internal disciplinary investigation? Because if that had been done at the time, and again, that probably goes back to your procedures, but to me, if that had been done at the time, you would have found out that there was no evidence, it would have been dealt with internally and we would have saved court time as well. So,
unfortunately, I think the law is quite, because it's police officers, if they always look to see, is a crime being committed first? Have they committed a crime? And I believe the advice from Crown Office to the Police Scotland is you shouldn't be doing any misconduct until they can certainly run a parallel investigation, but there comes a point where they shouldn't, they'll ask them to stop prior to it going to court. And I can understand that. But what we have at the low, if you look at conduct in general at the low level, we have officers going through court for things that if you worked in any other line of work, it wouldn't be going through court. It's because you're a police officer, and it'll go through a process and you'll end up in court for it may be a breach of the peace or whatever, where in any other profession it wouldn't go to court and it'd be dealt with by their misconduct. And if police service could get to that point, we would save so much time and money. One of the other issues is Crown will sit on a case for so long where the police are waiting on a decision to be made, which then causes an issue for the officer who's sitting waiting. And the current misconduct regs, if you go from start to finish, the timeline is 35 days. That's how long it should take for somebody being told and getting investigated to be at a hearing. It's 35 days. That's what it allows for. Now, I'm not saying that will depend on what the circumstances are, but that's not a long time. But let's be honest, we know that's not 35 days. The vast majority will probably be 365 days or more, and that's how long they take. So there are a lot of things that they could do currently within the current regulations that would fix, I think, a lot of the issues that have came to this committee.
We talk about trust and openness and transparency. Why would somebody not be told straight away the reason that they've been put onto restricted duties?
This is a concern that we've raised in the past. We've actually had officers in the past that have been told, you know you've done something wrong, but we're not telling you what it is, but you know what it is, and they still probably sit 10 years later and asking, I still don't know what I've done wrong. And this, it just seems to be an issue through, perhaps it's came through intelligence and they don't want to release a source, but this is a common issue that we have found. And we've found that with the drug testing as well, when officers are asked to provide a sample, they're not told and who's accusing them or where the evidences came from to say they've taken drugs, which is one of the biggest questions they always have. And if that question, for instance, is answered, that might allow somebody to say, right, okay, yeah, I was, or I wasn't even there, so why would you? That's not true. So it is a big concern, and the service will hide behind. The current regulations do state that the Deputy Chief Constable doesn't have to, on certain occasions, give certain information out. So I believe they will hide behind that to say they're not going to give that information. Now, there could be a legitimate reason at times. Perhaps it's been somebody close to that individual that's passed the information and they don't want to divulge that source. But it is alarming that somebody sits in that position, goes through a trial, found not guilty, and then goes to misconduct. There's no misconduct. Serious questions have to be asked why they were ever there in the first place.
Do you want to? Yeah, absolutely. So in terms of the criminal investigation, it usually takes precedence because exactly what David says, you know, to go to misconduct first could potentially prejudice a further criminal investigation thereafter. So, but there is capacity to run parallel investigations up to a certain point. So we acknowledge that as well. And just that piece, it's a punishing process in terms of having to go through that kind of investigation that takes place, and the time it takes sometimes seems to be inexplicably long to get responses back from Crown around about what would appear to be relatively minor matters before they're able to then remit to the misconduct procedures themselves at that point, which again will then start for the officers that are involved in that as well. So, you know, as areas of practice that could be improved, that for me would absolutely be one. And I think, you know, for someone to be told that you're subject to misconduct but we're not telling you what it is and why you are, that should be the absolute exception. You know, so there are circumstances, source protection, as David mentions, being one, where perhaps that is necessary, but you would expect that to be the absolute exception and, you know, a real judgment on the proportionality of doing that, given the impact on individuals through that process.
Yeah, I'd like to come in on that on behalf of staff as well. I recognise a lot of what David's saying from the Federation point of view. We have police officers investigating staff like it is a criminal investigation. That is what they are trained to do. It's our preference that that investigations into staff are carried out by staff, and that's something we're leaning into just now. A review of the policies and procedures would be very welcome by Unison, and something that we are trying to get in place. We do currently, the code of ethics that is currently in place on the first line says that this is not a discipline policy. That was actually fought and won by Unison on behalf of staff, because we couldn't see it coming in. Last week I had to ask someone to remove that from a letter, because it's put into a letter to say you've breached the code of ethics and that's why you're being investigated. My view as a representative, having gone into many cases with members who don't know what allegations they're facing, is even though, you make the best attempt to get the allegations from HR and from the investigating officer, is that it's conducted like an investigation. They want to see the reaction as a member comes in and is told what it is they have done. And reviewing those policies you've suggested is something that we could get rid of that and run that better.
Thank you. Just a quick, do you think the introduction of body-worn cameras will take away a lot of the complaints, because you'll have the video evidence there?
Absolutely. We have Europe and the rest of the world, that when body-worn cameras are there, they take away the issue. Officers will change their behaviour because they're actually recording it, they're on video, but it'll also stop a lot of malicious complaints coming in, where you can actually see what has happened and it's real and it's there. So we welcome body-worn cameras for that, and we do believe that will save the organisation a lot of money.
Fully support the introduction of body-worn video. We're clearly a late adopter in terms of the UK context, being the last force to roll it out, but it'll be a welcome addition to policing in Scotland once that's available to officers.
Maybe just bring in Pauline McNeill. I will come back to you, Sharon, if there's time at the end. Pauline McNeill, then Fulton McGregor.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Just to follow on from David Kennedy's response, and in fact David Malcolm's response about not being told what the accusation against you is very interesting, given that the previous panel we talked about the importance of human rights, but it's a fundamental right even under Scots law to know what you're accused of and who your accusers are, but doesn't seem to apply here to either staff or police officers.
The Police Scotland will say that the reason why they do it is the beginning of a criminal investigation. So what they are doing is telling the officer, you've been investigated for a crime, but at this time we can't tell you what it is, and we can't tell you who's made the allegations. Where, if they were working in another environment, they wouldn't tell them. It's because they're their employee, they work for them. They're having to tell them to remove them, put them in a restricted post because there's a risk, and that's where it comes from in general terms. The issues, though, that we see is, and it's not as bad as it used to be, I may add, is when officers were then told that they're not getting investigated for a crime, but somebody has gave them information about them that they can't then divulge to them to what it is, but we're going to have to move you because of the information that we've been told. That is so alarming for officers when they get that information, because they don't know why they've been moved, they don't know who's made the allegation against them. And all that does for me is actually their mental health is really affected by that, because they're then paranoid about every single person they work with and every single person around them to say who is saying X, Y or Z about me. So it is concerning. But that, I can understand at times why Police Scotland have to do it, but it does cause a concern.
Yeah. I mean, so the way I'm going to come at this line of questioning is I'm trying to understand what good this bill could do and what the gaps are. You know, if we weren't doing what was in this bill, seems that there's still things to resolve. Would you be able to provide the committee with any details around officers, the length of time that they've been waiting in court trials and things like that?
Certainly, we know that those officers have been waiting for you know, years. Mm-hmm. We'll have the details of how many.
I think that would be helpful.
Yeah.
To have that information.
Yeah, we can certainly get that for the committee.
David, I wanted to ask you in relation to staff, just what is the range of staff that you represent? Are there public facing staff that you represent?
Yes, you know, we have front counter, which is public facing. I would also say that, you know, our call centres are public facing. You know, they might not see a person, but they speak to a person. They're the first line of contact.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all range of staff all the way across. I have members who are in forensic services who are going out, you know, and meeting members of the public. So there's a lot of public facing staff.
So I'm very aware of your answers to the questions about the standards to which staff are held in relation to police officers and all of that, so that's mm-hmm. loud and clear. But do you think the public make the distinction when they phone Police Scotland and they get a staff member and they're maybe not happy? Do you think they make the distinction?
I'm not sure. I think language can be interesting when it comes to police staff. Even in this committee, we've referred quite a lot to civilians, and it's a misnomer. You know, police officers are civilians as well. They're not a military organisation. You know, so they're all civilians. So the distinction between officers and staff is a bit blurred. I think my colleagues at the Federation do a very good job of including us all as one, and obviously I have to represent the police staff and make that. So I think the distinction can be blurred, and members of the public are not always clear.
Can I ask David Kennedy and Ropi, is there anything in this bill that you think you can fully support, you think is useful?
I think the independence part of it is useful as long as it doesn't interfere with the operational independence of the Chief Constable from the investigation point of view. But in general terms, no, we feel as if the bill, what we currently have at the moment, is just not used properly, and we're throwing the baby out of the bathwater.
Thank you. Chief Superintendent here.
So as I've said, putting the code of ethics onto a statutory footing, I think, would do the mm-hmm. service no harm at all.
Yeah.
And I think that would place the ongoing commitment to standards really at the sort of heart of how we go about things. Similarly, we don't fall out with that, the view of independence that David has outlined there, again, with that constraint that the Chief needs to remain operationally independent. One of the discussions we've had with colleagues is around about the barred list, and albeit Police Scotland is the only police force within Scotland in the main, we do recognise that there's the BTP, the Ministry of Defence Police, and the Civil Nuclear Constabulary that also have a footprint here as well. So understanding whether or not that's the right thing for us to do has been one of the discussions. Now we feel that the same thing could be achieved through a better and more exhaustive use of references. However, if we were to go down the route of a barred list, we feel that that should not be one that's accessible to the public in the same way it is in England and Wales.
because the purpose of it is to ensure that policing isn't taking on anybody that's unsuitable for that role. So actually, in our broader policy context that we operate in, you know, we have the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act. We have things like the sentencing guidelines that talk about persons under the age of 26. And actually, the average age of your police officer is 24 for new recruits. And actually, it skews much younger than that, because what we tend to have is a lot who are much younger, and then one or two much older recruits. So potentially for one of those to be subject of misconduct proceedings and then have their name on a public barred list forever, I think is one that's not conducive to those officers' welfare ultimately. Just because they're no longer suitable to serve in policing, they have to exit the service, they do have to go on and lead a life outside of that. So I think the distinction between what's in the public interest and what's interesting to the public needs to be clearly made in terms of any barred list.
Do you think in the cases where police officers are before the court and there's no conviction, that the other misconduct issue related to that should automatically be dropped? If it's the same issue?
I think it
needs to... The court, so hear what you're saying. So you don't want to do it the other way around that Charan Dowie had suggested. Why don't you do it? Because it might prejudice the court case. So I suppose a higher court, obviously. If there's no conviction, why would the police continue to hold a misconduct disciplinary against the police officer when the court's already determined that?
I guess the answer to that would be because there still may be a breach of the standards of professional behaviour, right. And that's what misconduct looks at. You know, so obviously being convicted of a crime...
So does it prejudice the court case then?
If they looked at it in its entirety and elicited, you know, witness statements, etc., that would that would likely be the argument that was advanced.
I see, right. It just seems grossly unfair that you're getting tried for the same offence in the court and by the police. Fair enough. But it's the time scales. Yeah. And we've heard evidence loud and clear from Craig Naylor, which is really alarming, about the level of distress and mental health of officers. So everyone's prepared to defend themselves and, you know, deal with a charge against them. But it's the duration of waiting. Do you think there should be clear timescales in legislation that Police Scotland should have to abide by?
I think the timescales would be a welcome thing. And I think potentially it should extend to Crown Office around about charging decisions to try and... Because that sometimes seems to be the key challenge, is that things sit with Cap D for an extended period of time. And I don't think that's in anybody's interest.
Yeah, that's helpful. So trying to get my head around, you know, the range of complaints and misconduct that could be covered by the bill. Now, I did ask this question to the previous panel about, I'm just using an example of a case where clearly the line, and it was a long time ago, I'm trying to understand, would that happen today in your view? So the Emma Caldwell case, clearly the police investigation has been exposed, it's been really thin and going down the long lines of inquiry. What is the way in which a family who could clearly see that the police were investigating the wrong people, does this bill help in any way, or do we have other provisions that would prevent that happening today? I mean, because it's all very well talking about, you know, hypothetical situations, but we have examples of where the police have failed. And I know you can't account for what happened all that time ago, but I'm just trying to understand... To me, as a legislator, there isn't really much point in passing this bill unless it can actually fix things that have gone wrong.
You're absolutely right. It won't change that.
It won't.
It won't change that. This bill won't change that. I think you would have to have a way of members of a family would have to have another way in during an investigation to ask the questions that maybe need asked at that time. And that is really difficult. But I don't think this bill would change that from what you've said, Mrs. McNeill.
So I think the Emma Caldwell case is a hugely complex one, and I'm cognizant, obviously, of the announcement of a public inquiry into it, so I'll reserve, you know, detailed comment. But I do think that the experience of similar circumstances would be different today. I think the service has moved on, and I think society has moved on from some of the predominant issues in that. But I think that offering a route into a grieving family who are not satisfied with police conduct, I think there needs to be, it's a light we should shine on ourselves and look to see if we can improve. And I think it's not clear to me that this bill would offer that.
Just lastly, on this whole question of whether an independent body is the answer, here's my concern about that, which I don't have a view on, but so some of the inner papers, one of the examples of a complaint might be where the police officer used too much restraint, someone complains. That must be a difficult judgment to make for anyone. But if you've got no experience of restraint, how can you make a judgment about a complaint against a police officer if you have never carried it out yourself? That's a question I have about whether an independent, completely independent body is the answer.
I disagree with that, and one of the issues you've got, I mean, the independence came up in Scotland because we moved away from 8 police forces to 1.
Mm-hmm.
Where before, what would happen is another police force would then come in and investigate that police service, which worked. It did work. And actually, in our experience of police officers being investigated by their peers is they probably get a really harder time. And I think you'll find that it's interesting to see what's happened in England and Wales, where a lot of then Dame Ailish, now Lady Ailish's comments are now getting turned back. They're now changing from what she recommended. They're now reversing that because they're realising a lot of it just doesn't work. And I think for this bill, we are in a very good opportunity to, when we've not passed it or passed the regulations haven't changed, to look at that, to see is that necessary? Is that really going to achieve, is what you've said, what we're actually trying to achieve? Because it's about public perception and are the public satisfied with how the police are being investigated and how that is transforms at the nth degree when the final result comes out. And I think that those questions have to be asked. And what is it we're actually trying to achieve by this? We certainly feel that a lot of the influences came from outside of Scotland. It's not cases that have happened in Scotland. For a lot of some of the changes that we're looking at and the scrutiny that the police go under, because 99.9% of police officers are just doing their job and they're doing a great job. But we welcome those comments.
Thank you. And I think in relation to another example would be of Wayne Cousins, mm-hmm. who had a prior record. You said, Chief Sipper, that you've already, Police Scotland have already vetted officers. So that would root out something like that, would it?
So there was a UK national re-vetting of every police officer within Scotland. That was our portion of that, was the 23,000 police officers within Scotland. Absolutely. And that re-vetting piece needs to be carried out on a routine basis to make sure that we continue to have that. But again, for my membership, if I look at police superintendents and chief superintendents, the number of those who are subject to misconduct and gross misconduct is vanishingly small, and particularly in terms of gross misconduct, is proportionately much smaller than the numbers in the rest of the UK. Of the extent you might expect.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Before I bring in Fulton McGregor just to ask some final questions, I wonder if I can just pick up on the exchange around the barred list. You made some comments about that. And I was wondering if I just can open up that to our other panel members, just to get your sense of the benefit of a barred list and also the proposals around an advisory list and or barred list. So it's a general question, but I'll maybe come back to you, Chief Superintendent Hay, and then I'll work across the panel. Just in general, if you have other comments to make, just in terms of ASP's position on the proposals around a barred an advisory list.
So it's one that we wouldn't necessarily disagree with, but it is one that we would say could be achieved through other means, a better use of provision of employment references, for example. I know that there is a desire to kind of match the broader UK position around about this, from within the force. However, there needs to be that wider consideration around about the impact on individual officers, and the fact that any member of the public can go in and look at the College of Policing lists, I think is one that I can't understand the proportionality and rationale of that. It's meant to be a tool that's there for policing, to ensure that people don't get a job in policing, but actually it could, the impact of it could ensure that people don't get a job at all. If people are going in and looking at that. And, you know, as someone who has served as the chair on misconduct panels, even when people are dismissed from the service, there is often significant mitigation, you know, and sometimes quite tragic circumstances associated with it. And that, you don't see that within a barred list. That isn't expressed, you know. So all you see is the person that has left the service. So actually, the interest of balance in this is to be around about what is the overall objective, which is to make sure that we're protecting the public and that people who shouldn't be working in policing aren't working in policing. It isn't simply to put a list of you know, potentially salacious details about people who may then find their lives being probed to find out more information.
Thanks for that. That's helpful. David, have you got...
I'll be quite succinct in this because, as far as I'm aware, there's no consideration of a banning list for staff.
Yeah.
Within it, certainly no one is engaged with us on that. But I'd certainly hold a view if that was to become a consideration. We're back to what I raised earlier, which is that becomes a regulated workforce,
yeah,
with different provisions, and we would have to challenge that.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. And David Kennedy.
Yeah. Thanks. We don't agree with the barred list. Particularly in the reference to what Rob's made in England and Wales, with the public being able to view it. Mm-hmm. I'm not aware of any police officer who's resigned from Police Scotland, who's then went on to have a job in another police service. Mm-hmm. The issues that they've seen in England and Wales is because people are living, working and probably socialising, and sometimes in three or four different police areas. They're not talking to each other, and clearly they're allowing officers to leave and to get rid of them just to transfer them to other police force services. In Scotland, they're very robust with that. And in recent months, I know they're now giving references more so. What used to happen is they would say, such and such joined the police, left the police. That was the reference.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're seeing now more is they're actually saying, this is what this individual has went through in the mm-hmm. service, or this is what this individual was going through,
mm-hmm.
and they're actually publicising that. So the bad list for me, is, as Rob's pointed out, it paints a picture, but it doesn't give you the whole story.
Mm-hmm.
And I generally don't think it's something that's needed in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
I'm generally unaware of any officer who has went into a job where it's transpired that says they shouldn't be in that job because what's happened within the police service, and that should come down to the proper vetting that would take place. So certainly if they were going to introduce a barred list, we're certainly totally against an advisory list, because that's advisory list doesn't even allow somebody gets an allegation before they retire, they could end up on an advisory list when they've not been through any process.
Yeah.
So, on the barred list, it would have to be, if it was going to be introduced, it has to be solely for police purposes, or solely if somebody had to come in to ask, if somebody was going for a job, they would have to ask the service, are they on the barred list?
Mm-hmm.
We wouldn't want it to be something that's in a public domain. That was just, and probably from what David Malcolm said, I don't think if it was a police staff member and they were going to do that, there would be an outcry. We'd certainly rather that would be the case for that.
Okay, thanks for that. I think you is it supplementary you want to ask?
To point something,
okay,
Mr. Kennedy said, that's the first.
Very quickly.
I just understand correctly, I think you said that you weren't aware of any particular cases of officers leaving Police Scotland and getting a job elsewhere when they were subject to outstanding issues or complaints.
It's getting another job within another police service, for instance.
Right.
If I'm aware of officers who have attempted to join another police service who have left prior to their misconduct being finalised, and they haven't been appointed because they have to go through another Police Scotland or written to and asked, has that officer been through?
There have been quite high profile cases. I mean, it's a matter of public record that two Police Scotland chief constables left while subject to complaints, quite serious complaints on the face of it, were unresolved and then ended up getting jobs and policing elsewhere in the UK.
Well, the policing jobs and elsewhere in the UK shouldn't have employed them if they'd asked the correct questions. That's the point we're making.
Right.
For police officers, they would leave the employer. The other employer has to write to them and say, they can get a reference from them if they've left that service. And that's what happens with police officers. I think the question there you have to ask is, if other employers know that's happened, then the question's on them. Because if it's in public, if it's known public,
does it not bring us back to the point about complaints going unresolved, where they can't presumably be penalised potentially by a new employer because the complaint dies with the exit from service?
Absolutely. Well, they can't be, but they can certainly ask what has happened within that previous employer.
Right.
And I've had officers who have faced misconduct or been found proven, who have then had to write to their employer and came to us as a staff association to ask what the circumstances were, explain the circumstances, and those officers would then be given a job because they understand the reasons behind their misconduct. But what I don't think to have a barred list, though, would be fair to have a barred list when somebody leaves the service who's not been found guilty of a misconduct, not been found proven of any crime, and then they're automatically barred just because they've left before that had finalised. That would not be fair on that individual.
Is that what's proposed, though? Sorry.
I know it's an interesting point, but I'm going to have to bring in Fulton McGregor.
Thanks. You said that almost reluctantly, like, you have to bring me in. good afternoon to the panel. Just a couple of quick questions to give you an opportunity to have your view in these parts of the bill. The first one I want to ask about is for your views on the provision within the bill which introduces the ability to commence or continue gross misconduct proceedings against former officers. What is your views on that? I'll start with yourself, David Kennedy, if you want, and then walk to the left.
I can understand people's perceptions to think why they would want to do this, but I don't think it's going to... I think it's a waste of time. I think it's going to cost a lot of money, as we've seen down in England and Wales. And ultimately, if an officer, a lot of officers resign prior to misconduct because of the process. They also resign because they can, because of the pensions and how it works, where they've attained so many years' service, they're allowed to retire. I don't know any other profession that we would turn in a few. Somebody left their employment, we would then continue that misconduct for them. I'm not aware of any other profession that would happen in. We are not in a regulated where regulations govern us, but we're not like doctors or nurses where we have a licence to police. That's not how it works for police officers. And the amount of money and time that I believe would be wasted in that would far outweigh the actual result of what it's trying to achieve.
David, you're welcome.
Well, obviously, I wouldn't comment on for officers, as I don't represent officers, but for staff, again, it's the same as I've said before. If you're wanting to pursue someone, there are other means. You know, if someone, you know, if it was a criminal act, then it would be a court that would be doing so. If it was, you know, an employment matter, then your employment rights, if you've left the job, you've left the job. That should be the end of it.
Okay. It seems, you know, rather academic if you consider that the ultimate sanction for gross misconduct is to lose your job. If somebody's already out the job, then what are we achieving by putting them through that process? And I think the problem is people equate wrongly the misconduct process with the criminal justice process. So if someone's subject to criminal proceedings, that is justice having its go. Misconduct is a professional misconduct process, and as I say, the ultimate sanction is you lose your job. So if you already have left the job, what is it we're trying to achieve there, I guess I would ask. And you know, there's unanswered questions around about timescales. So how long would we potentially, you know, could we go back? Because the things that you know, as I've said it already to the committee, things change in society, things change in organisations. So do we risk applying today's lens to things that have taken place a decade ago and beyond that? So I think we would have some real
challenges around about that.
Okay, thanks for that. And a final question is, I'm just looking for your thoughts on some of Lady Angelini's recommendations, and these include, for example, the introduction of accelerated hearings where the evidence is perhaps not disputed, or where the subject officer admits their behaviour being misconduct, and also for these misconduct hearings to be held in public. What's your thoughts on those? I know there's a few things in there, but happy just to go left to right again.
On the accelerated hearings, as I said earlier, 35 days from start to finish under the current misconduct. That's how many days. So I think that's quite speedily for somebody to, and somebody is going to admit. That's what the current regulations were meant to do. They were meant to be in it, allow you to, if somebody was going to admit misconduct, then it would take you to that entity very quickly. I don't agree with the accelerated for probationers. I think we run the risk of targeting individuals who have just come into a job who perhaps for no fault of their own have then had an allegation made against them, and then you're just going to sack them because they're probationer. I don't agree with that. I think that everybody should go through the same process. I think that's fair and it's transparent and it meets natural justice. So I would agree that. And sorry, I've got the last point.
About the being in public.
Absolutely, we wouldn't want it in public. For me, it's like a public flogging of an individual, and the information we get from England and Wales is it's not helped. In actual fact, it probably catapults the issues surrounding that individual into the public domain more, and I don't actually see what purpose it would have. Ultimately, if a complainer under the current regulations wishes to be at a misconduct, they can be. They can ask to be there, the chair can allow them to be there, and they can be there right until the point of the officer receives what the finding is, where whatever the discipline outcome will be. Also, our police appeals tribunals, they're in public if people wish to attend. They're now being advertised for those that are coming up. So there is that opportunity if it then goes to that nth degree for people to attend. But my concern with having, under the current status with the way gross misconduct is in the high bar that's set, is we are just going to have a circus for media, a circus for lawyers to make a lot of money, and it won't actually get the justice that people actually think it's going to achieve.
Yes, that's really helpful. David Malcolm, are you wanting to come in?
Yeah, I mean, it's not applicable really to staff, is it? Misconduct to staff is an employment matter. It's a matter of contract, so you know you would be infringing upon a right of privacy, it's your fundamental human rights if anything like that was to be held in public.
Okay, thanks for that. Again, helpful, Robbie.
Yeah, thanks. So anything that expedites the process more quickly, I think, is to be welcomed. But as David said, there's provision for that in the existing regulations. So to what extent? We need to understand better why that hasn't been successful and try to potentially fix that first, I think. And I guess in terms of the holding of hearings in public, as I say, I've been served as a chair and an assessor in misconduct panels, and that process requires often the disclosure of really personal information by officers. As I say, sometimes quite tragic information, sometimes medical information. And I think it would be fundamentally wrong to force them to recount that in public. It feels more like a desire to put them in the stocks rather than to have a balanced process, which is all about ultimately ensuring the standards of the service and protecting the public. I don't see there's anything else to be gained in that, and in fact, potentially quite a lot to be lost.
Okay, thanks again.
Okay, thank you. Just picking up a couple of points, you spoke about the 35-day time frame for hearings. Is that, are Police Scotland able to comply with that? Is that manageable?
They can, convener. The investigation part of it is the part that would probably make it longer.
Yeah.
But if somebody was told they had served a form to say you are being in acute allegations X, they could, if that individual says it's misconduct, and that's the big part of it. If it was misconduct, they're more than likely to say, well, I might accept it, but if it's gross misconduct and I face losing my job, I might have to take a think about it. However, that would be 35 days. If they accepted it at that point, that's the process, and that's how long it would take.
Yeah, OK, thanks. That's helpful. clarification. Okay, that's been an interesting session. We've covered quite a lot. So thank you very much all for coming along today. We really appreciate your time. And that concludes the public part of our meeting, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you very much. Thank you.